Welcome, everyone. Delighted to welcome Meera Subramanian, our speaker this afternoon. Thanks to all of you who've taken time off Unmukt to come, although this is part of Unmukt, as you will have noticed on your program schedule. It's a very sly tactic on my side, I think. Meera Subramanian is a journalist who's written in very distinguished journals. She writes on a variety of issues concerning nature, culture, and faith. She also edits an online literary nonfiction journal called Killing the Buddha. I invite Meera to give a talk.
Thank you. Let's see, how does this sound? Can you, is that mic working? Yeah, can you hear him back? Okay. Great, thank you for having me. It's really great to be here. I will do maybe about 45 minutes of just talking about this book, Elemental India, which is about stories from across the country of people who are facing some major environmental challenges in their own backyard with micro solutions, both working and challenging both. So I'll share some photos and some drawings, and we'll have plenty of time for questions. But I'd love to know who I'm talking to. So how many students are here? Okay. And then faculty, NGOs, anybody else? Okay. Great. And the students are coming from the development side? Is that the interest? Okay, good. So start thinking about questions. But first, let's talk about how I even came to write this book. So my name, Meera Subramanian, sounds like I shouldn't be speaking the way that I am. And so part of that reason is the backstory of that my father is from Madras, from Chennai, and my mother's from Chicago. So I was born and raised in the US, but my dad really maintained a strong connection to his family in Chennai. So this was my very first visit. I'm 18 months old in 1972, there in my mom's arms, probably slightly overwhelmed. My brother looks terrified. So every few years, we would come to India to visit family and go to weddings and things. And each time I came, I was changing as I grew up, but also India was just going through major transformations, a very quickly transforming country. So I would see this in 1980, this is the village where my father was born. And then by the 90s, you had the National Stock Exchange in Mumbai. So especially in the 90s, when economic reforms kicked in, India really entered a whole new generation that you are a direct result of. In that same time frame, to go back to a little bit of what I was going through in the 90s, I graduated from undergraduate work and undergraduate school in anthropology, but I was really interested and passionate about environmental issues. So I had just gone directly into the NGO field. I was working, actually most of my 20s, I was in a small farm in rural Oregon. We were growing organic vegetables and cooking over an open fire with these fuel-efficient wood cook stoves and building homes and heating our homes with wood that we gathered from the forest around us. So I was in some ways heading back towards my father's village in terms of lifestyle. And India, in the meanwhile, was sort of racing in the other direction of becoming more and more developed. But interestingly, now that it's been a full generation of this form of development, the lags are becoming really apparent. And when you look hard at the numbers of Indians that are lacking basic electricity, 25%. Two-thirds are still cooking over an open fire for at least part of their daily needs. More than half don't have access to clean water. So my question, guiding me during my 20s and then as I shifted into journalism in my 30s, was how to address these questions of how to get those resources that everyone needs, all 7 billion of us on this planet, a fifth of them here in India, how do we get those basic needs fulfilled for people without wrecking the environment further? We're already dealing with a lot of environmental degradation in India and elsewhere. So those questions of how to get electricity to people, how to get people off of biomass and onto cleaner fuels, how to do those things in a sustainable fashion that doesn't further compromise the environment. So that was kind of the driving question about the book. So I took those interests from my 20s in the NGO work and the past 10 years as a journalist addressing those same questions that grew into basically the idea of this book. This is my first book, so in order to kind of be able to wrap my head around it and also to make it something that readers would enjoy reading, I decided to use the framework of the Panchamahabhuta, the idea of the five elements, to tell five different narrative stories from around the country. So that meant that I went to, I covered a lot of ground in the process of reporting for this. It was about 3 years of working on the book. I came here as multiple trips that were months long. I came as a Fulbright Narrative Fellowship, really helped me get a chunk of the reporting done. And I covered a large swath of the country and yet still barely skimmed the surface. It's an amazingly diverse, huge place. And so, but I did come here to Bangalore. I was down in Karnataka, and I'll talk a little bit about that. So just briefly, I'm gonna go through the five elements. I'll maybe pause and read from a couple sections here and there. Starting off with Earth. So Earth, the question of feeding India's population was very, very relevant when India became independent. At that point, India was very dependent on imports for a lot of its food and was very cognizant of the fact that there was a growing population. So I focus mostly, I'll talk a little bit about Karnataka, but where I went to farms there, but I'll primarily focus on Punjab. So this is the breadbasket of the nation, right? Almost half of the rice comes from here, huge amounts of wheat and cotton come from here. And so this area, as being a really fertile area, was a target for the Green Revolution. And so in the 60s and 70s, this began, and this was basically a technique for modern agriculture that used a combination of high-yield seeds and high inputs of fertilizers and insecticides and pesticides, along with high quantities of water. And so the chemicals now, 40 years into using Green Revolution techniques, the chemicals are just literally everywhere. They're used in, you know, they're turned into bags to carry your tiffin to work. They were sadly in the vegetable oil container that was used for a Bihari midday meal, where they used an old insecticide container to put vegetable oil in, and two dozen children died in the process. So these chemicals are literally everywhere. They're permeated the soil and the groundwater. They're in our very cells, just with the food that we're getting, as well as the farmers that are working directly with these chemicals. And so the Green Revolution in many ways did work. Yields go really high up when you add all those inputs initially, but what happens over the long term is that those yields then stagnate, sometimes they even drop, and all of the environmental and health costs start coming due. So cancer rates in Punjab are higher than they are anywhere else in the country. There's a cancer train that travels to Rajasthan for treatment on a daily basis. And to understand just the concentration of the chemical use in this area, Punjab is just like less than 2% of the landmass of India. It's a very small area, yet about 17% of the pesticides are used in this one state. So we're talking about really high concentrations. And so the question is, how do you address this? How do you get food to people in a more sustainable way that isn't so harmful for the farmers who are working it, for the consumers who are eating the food grown on it, and for the soil? So I focused on the work of Kheti Virasat Mission, which is working on teaching farmers that are there in Punjab more natural organic techniques. And each chapter I would try to have the overarching question of the book was there about how do we do this sustainably, live on the earth and get everything we need. The chapter in this question was like, would India starve? You know, this is like a very legitimate question. The famines in Bengal killed millions in the 1940s. This is very recent history. So this question is very relevant. You know, maybe the Green Revolution has to happen in order to get the food to people, and all this other stuff is just collateral damage we have to live with. But I went out seeking the farmers who might be able to tell me something different. When I posed this question to farmers, you know, would India starve if it switched to organic? I got the whole spectrum of answers. Two brothers, the one with the scarf over his head, said yes, India would starve. You consumers, you don't care what you're eating. You just wanted to be cheap. That's all you care about. He used the chemicals on his half of the family lands. And then the other brother with the turban, he had had health problems, and he felt like they were coming partly from these chemicals that were being used. And he went natural on his half of the family lands. So I would get this, you know, cup half full, cup half empty, quite a bit. One farmer I met was Gora Singh. He was very typical. India is a land of small farmers, so Gora has 5 acres, very typical. And he was doing a slow transition. So just in case things weren't working with this new fangled organic stuff, he was switching 2 acres to organic so far. He'd been having really positive results. He was watching his soil come back to life. He was using a combination of all these different techniques. He was using traditional jivamruta, like a combination of cow urine and manure and bio, like neem plants for insecticides, natural insecticides, and using crop rotation. So he would plant legumes that help bring nitrogen to the soil before he would plant a heavy crop like corn that needed a lot of nitrogen. So he was just reintroducing a lot of techniques that that his grandfather used, you know. And when one way he described it, he said that, "I always used chemicals on my plants because I didn't know you couldn't." You know, he was the generation that had never known anything different. Usually I read a little section from about Gora, but because I'm here, I'm going to read the section from Karnataka, just to bring us local. And I'll bring us right to Electronic City. Why not, right? "Far from Punjab, I later stood on a corner in a place known as Electronic City on the outskirts of the southern city of Bengaluru." Who says Bangalore? Who says Bengaluru? Bangalore? Bangalore. I always seem to say the wrong one. I'll use Bangalore today. The city's rapid growth during the information technology boom made it the Silicon Valley of India, home of such IT giants as Infosys and Wipro, and development had spilled over into the once quiet countryside. When I arrived in 2013, Electronic City felt like it had fallen from the sky and the dust was still settling. Building cranes dominated the emerging skyline, adding layers to freshly poured concrete buildings surrounded by bamboo scaffolding. Cows trotted down the street, startled by the passing of corporate buses where there had once been bullock carts. My cousin Pavitra was traveling with me, and we were bound for an organic farm of a very different sort than what I'd seen in Punjab, one that reflected a new India as buzzing as Bengaluru. A silver Tata pickup truck stopped in front of us, and Namit MVS, who went simply by Namit, stepped out to greet us. The owner of First Agro and a first-generation farmer, he instantly reminded me of Hashish Ahuja, which was one of the farmers I'd met up in Punjab. He was tall and fit, a man who left India for North America, where he flew as a pilot in Canada for 8 years, and then had returned to India to reinvent himself as a modern farmer. He wore a white-collared t-shirt, periwinkle shorts, hiking boots, and a crooked smile with a broken front tooth. At 35 years old, Namit had ambitions that far exceeded those of coffee cup-toting Ashish. Namit wanted to take what he called zero pesticides, certified to international standards, gourmet and epicurean, to scale. First Agro's objective was to go big and to do it fast, without any agrochemicals. Namit and his brother Naveen founded the company to bring high-end organic produce and fruit to the growing Indian elite market. So he was raised like all over the world, Singapore, Japan, they traveled all over. And so he and his brother, who actually is still based in Japan, bought 45 acres here in Mysore district, and they had started this farm back in 2013. He said, "I don't know if this is gonna work. I figure either way will be a textbook case. Either this is how you do it, or this is how you don't." So we drove from Bangalore down 3 hours to the farm. Namit did not hail from a lineage of agriculturalists. He learned to farm, he said, from 800 hours of YouTube education. He passed the enology glean to his workers each time he circled the farm, pruned the rows of beefsteak tomatoes to fight the verticillium wilt that was making the green forms stunted in comparison to their compatriots on either side, set up the small tractor to run a pump spray to spray neem oil on cucumbers that were afflicted with cucumber beetles, which lit up like sparks in the sunlight. Production and water efficiency were a high priority. All the fields were set with drip irrigation line, which conserves vast quantities of water and targets the moisture directly to the plant's roots. There were lines of San Marzano tomatoes with small mango trees planted among them. Volunteer basil plants occasionally stroked our ankles, permitted to grow wherever a stray seed had taken root. Fields of peppers contained 46 different varieties, and he filled my cupped hands with samples of Thai black bird's eye and Trinidadian bishop's crown, the colors and shapes a screaming reminder of the biodiversity lacking in an Indian cuisine that depends on one variety of green chili capsicum only, one variety of tomato, one variety of onion. There's a huge variation in cuisine across India, from the Mughal-influenced meat dishes of the north to the coconut-infused flavors of the southern coasts. But the variety of ingredients is limited, captured in the handful of green chilies tossed in your satchel after buying vegetables from any street vendor. So so I posed this question to Namit, would India starve? We had gone back to, we toured his farm and then gone back to the main building. He had, I think there were like 8 puppies or something that he'd just gotten. He'd adopted all these dogs. There was tons of these puppies are running all over us. So I asked Namit, would India starve if it transitioned to organic? Yes, he said without hesitating. We just can't produce the yields needed. It was the complete opposite of what Vinod Jani, another farmer in Punjab, had answered. Namit, though a cheerful enough fellow, was pessimistic about the possibility of organic reaching the masses of India's hungry. He thought India was heading for a disaster, maybe not in my lifetime, but in my grandchildren's, if I have them. There will be 2 billion people in India alone by then. Where will people live, let alone grow their food? It will all be imported. Unlike the farmers I had met in Punjab who saw their move to organic as a social good akin to fighting for political independence, Namit was in it for the money and for the food. An unabashed capitalist, he didn't embrace the adoption of pre-independence modes of agriculture. He shunned even the idea of using Jivamrutra. It's filled with unknown bacteria and fungi, he said, a completely non-standardized process. And he didn't rail much about corporate agribusiness. He wanted little to do with organic activism. He was reticent when I asked him about Vandana Shiva, but said she got one thing right. Control your seeds, he said, and you control your future. Even with the lack of diversity apparent at Indian produce markets, heirloom seeds, diverse and indigenous, still survived across India. As for genetically modified varieties, they didn't even warrant his attention. I don't believe in that shit, he said. Not because of health, but that they own it. I just ate that tomato. It's in my belly. You're gonna say that it's your property? What Namit cared about was making a good living and bringing food to people who cared about it. Don't wear the hippie hat, the communist hat, he said. Don't grow food to feel good. Self-help groups are fine, but make it a profitable business that feeds people. So this is one, and this was the amazing thing about going out and reporting and asking people these questions and hearing what they said, is that you would get the full range of answers. Another farmer that I referred to said we could go organic overnight, no problem. So throughout the book, I tried to balance out these stories that I heard on the ground from people who were living these experiences day to day with science to figure out what they were experiencing had feasibility, really, on a larger scale. And what I found was kind of amazing was that in regards to organic agriculture, there's actually strong scientific evidence that this is possible to head in this direction. A big part of using green revolution techniques is that you're feeding the plant and you're also depending on high inputs of water. In Punjab, the water table is in free fall. A fifth of Indian wells are compromised. There's not any evidence that we can continue to extract at that rate. So thinking about how to incorporate things like what Namit is saying of drip irrigation, water conservation on that level, and then building the soil instead of relying on the inputs to feed the plant, you cultivate the soil so that it can grow strong plants. So, Gwara Singh held out some of the organic part of his soil, and he's like, smell this, it's alive. And the science backs that up. There's a place in Michigan that has been studying this exact thing about how much do you need to put chemical inputs in order to get the yield to feed people. And if you don't put the nitrogen fertilizer in, your yield with organic is 80% of what it is with so-called conventional, with the chemicals. So that's substantial. We need that fifth, we need that fifth of that quantity to feed people. But what they've found at this research center, studying this for a quarter of a century, is that you can reduce those inputs, maybe not totally, not purely organic, but really reduce them, and then incorporate the things that the more traditional farmers are doing, like the crop rotation and the manuring and composting and all of these things, and you get yields that are the same without all the runoff. A lot of the nitrogen that gets put on, some goes to the plant, and lots, 50% runs off into the water and causes all sorts of other problems. So finding these thresholds can be the key to doing this. Another way is through ideas like agroforestry, agroecology, looks at a farm as an entire system. Instead of just considering the plants and thinking of it as monocropping, which is the direction that most of this industrial agriculture goes, instead consider the whole farm as an ecosystem. So you're trying to keep inputs in, you're trying to have it be more of a circular economy within the farm environment. And they've done this on 35 million acres in Africa, and they found doubling of yields in under 10 years. Likewise, system of crop intensification, SCI, focuses more attention on individual plants. These methods have been studied since Madagascar 30 years ago, and studies right here from India and Bihar were showing like 86% higher yields in rice, like game-changing numbers. So all of these techniques are proving themselves scientifically and could be the way to answer these questions about how to grow food sustainably without compromising the soil and without compromising water and human health. So the evidence is there. Again, you're taking like the best of the old traditional knowledge from our grandfathers as well as what Namita is thinking of modern drip technology, all these modern devices as well. So that was agriculture. The second element took me was water, so that took me to Rajasthan. And I went to the Alwar district, where it's always been a very semi-arid landscape. It's never been a moist place, but 30, 40 years ago, the wells had just completely run dry. Livestock couldn't be supported, agriculture couldn't be supported, and the men literally had just left the region looking for work elsewhere. And then the work of Tarun Bharat Sangh, under the guidance originally of Rajendra Singh, started building just small johads, these small dams all across the landscape. And the idea is that you're just catching these very fleeting, ephemeral monsoon rains that come and helping them pause along the landscape just enough behind these little dams to be able to percolate down and recharge those aquifers. Really basic, and again, tapping back into traditional methods of water collection that had been in evidence all across South Asia and in many respects had just been lost during the colonial period. So a part of it was reviving it. I spent a lot of time with Kanahia in his village that had been, he got involved with this organization when he was 20, 25 years old, had been doing this for the past 20 years and had basically seen his village come back to life. And everywhere with climate change and just changing weather patterns, this alternation between drought and deluge, where the rains come in shorter periods of time and fall harder and faster, makes systems like this even more relevant, because when you've got those really heavy rains, the water just rushes off and it's taking topsoil with it. So you've got erosion combined with lack of water, and you're just alternating between flooding and drought. Systems like this help, again, finding that threshold, finding that moderation point to try to bring those two places together. So this is Kanahia's village, and it had basically come back to life. These lands that we're looking at here in this photo were barren 20 years ago and are now fully back in operation. Again, this shows the power of all these small scale techniques applied widely over a landscape. You know, the alternate means of getting water to Indians is the idea or the concept of mega dams and of interlinking river project. If the interlinking river project were to happen, it would be the largest engineering feat on the face of the planet. The ecological and human toll of such major moving rivers, nobody could really know what the unintended consequences of that and the fight for trying to even implement something like that. Removing, displacing whole entire communities is really questionable. Efforts like what was happening in Rajasthan don't have all of those costs accompanying them. And the third element was fire, and so this was interesting. This took me all over. I was down here in Tamil Nadu and up in Maharashtra, but everywhere I was traveling for this book, I would see the evidence of the fact that 160 million households in India are still dependent on this wood. Women with huge loads on top of their head, kids scrambling up trees, cutting the last remaining branches. This was a house in Bihar that was just covered with dung patties that were drying. And the health impacts of this are just staggering. I mean, when I wrote this book, the Global Burden of Disease study had determined that 4 million people a year are dying from the smoke from these fires. So that's like 4 million. How do you wrap your head around that huge of a number? That's more than malaria and HIV AIDS and tuberculosis combined. So we spend a lot of time thinking about how to solve those health problems, but very little is talked about with just especially women and children bearing the brunt of sitting over these fires day after day. Just literally in the past week or two, that number seems to have gone up to 5.5 million. So I mean, each time they study this, it seems like the impact is even greater than previously believed. On top of the human health impact, there's a huge climate impact. So this is this was taken on my way to Mumbai, but I was spending time in Delhi on this trip. The air quality is there literally is a black cloud over South Asia. It's estimated that about a fifth of this pollution is actually generated from inside the home from these cook stoves. So this is a tremendous, you can't even say indoor versus outdoor air quality. Now they just call it ambient air quality because it's really so intricately intertwined. You know, even in the cities, about 10% of the problems that we're facing in Delhi and other major cities are coming from these biomass stoves being used on a daily basis. So again, this book, I was trying to find hopeful stories and hopeful answers. This one was a little more complicated. When I was working in my 20s with a nonprofit organization in rural Oregon, part of the work we did was actually building and developing fuel-efficient wood cook stoves. So this right here is an Envirofit stove. This is a spin-off of some of the designs that we came up with there in Oregon. And the idea is that you're building a highly efficient wood cook stove. It's well insulated. Smoke is actually just incomplete combustion. So if you can make that fire burn really hot, it'll burn really clean. And then you get a fire that looks gorgeous like this, where it's all fire and no smoke. The tricky thing was that when I went out to really look for these stoves in action, they were not really being used on a widespread basis. This was this is an example from Maharashtra here. These stoves, the improved stove is the one in the corner that's not being used. And all the ingredients were good for this project. Cummins, it was part of a CSR program, so the women got the stoves for free. A really great NGO that was working in the area that was well regarded helped distribute the stoves, and it was a fairly well-designed, low-cost stove. It had like nice fire bricks that were surrounded by something that a potter could do locally. It had an air intake hole to help it get that combustion complete. And yet the women were just not using them. And it was a whole host of reasons. That air intake hole, that was where the scorpions and snakes were gonna live. So the first thing they did was plug that up. So then it's not burning as cleanly. And it didn't get it quite hot enough. So the roti didn't cook the way that they liked it to. So then they fired up the chula. Or they did like it, but then the wires fell apart once it got burnt out. And they just called the local potter to fix it. And then they're back to a chula instead of an improved stove. So a lot of these cultural reasons seem to really come into play. And I think that's a huge important thing when we're thinking about development, that technology is providing a lot of amazing answers in many respects. But then there's this huge cultural component that needs to be contended with. Because the stoves do often work really great in the labs. How do you translate that to having them work great? They only work great if they're actually being used. And I found like a hint of answer actually here in Elathigiri in Tamil Nadu, where it's a little bit more developed than some of the kitchens that I was seeing in Maharashtra. And what you see is a slightly messy kitchen like this, where this woman actually on a daily basis was using four different stoves. You know, she'd use the kerosene and LPG as long as the subsidies lasted. And she had an Envirofit, one of those improved cook stoves that she'd bought through a self-help group that she was part of, you know, voluntarily with her own money. And then outside downstairs, she had a three-stone fire that she used to heat up bath water with the coconut fronds that fell off the tree next door. And this is the stove designers call this stove stacking. And it's actually something all of us probably in this room do on a daily basis, right? We probably have a geyser to heat our water, maybe an LPG stove, maybe a rice cooker. So we have all these different methods. And this is actually like a really positive step in terms of development. It's just like slowly get people off biomass. At the same time, there were certain researchers who've been working on these stoves for 40 years, and they just said, why are we even bothered trying to get these improved cook stoves to women? We wouldn't use them. Why are we asking poor women to use them? Like, if we improve our vehicle fleet emissions by 1%, we can offset all of the fossil fuel, I mean, all of the carbon impact of switching poor women to like clean, dependable fuels, even if they're fossil fuels. Or take it one step further and think about that 25% of the population that doesn't have electricity. Maybe getting really focusing development efforts on renewable microgrids or something to get that power to people that offers all these different benefits, and then you can start thinking about dependable electrical induction stoves or something in that direction. So this basically raised the idea, I mean, I know it sounds like a lot of the students work with NGOs. I love NGOs. I have a deep passion for the work of NGOs and have done that for half of my adult life. And so I believe in that work tremendously, but then there's also the need to recognize when there are limitations to the work that's being done within that realm. There is, I realized as I reported on this, if you're working for an NGO, you have to say that what you're doing is successful. Like, that's how the funding stays happening, right? So that is a really challenging thing because it is not conducive to just being really honest about the things that are lacking about the programs that NGOs are undertaking. I was really impressed with the work of JPAL, is the Jamil Poverty Action Lab. I don't know if anybody knows that, based out of MIT. Very active in South Asia. They're using randomized controlled trials to try to test some of these theories, you know, like what are NGOs and governments doing? You know, is it better to just give away the bed nets to fight malaria? Is it better to give a deworming pill to kids to keep them in school? Like, what are all these social programs that are in effect? What's working? What's not? What gives you the biggest bang for the buck? So Jay Powell was looking at some of these things like cook stoves as well as many of these other issues. And that approach seemed to me to make a lot of sense in terms of really trying to have NGOs maybe just detach a teeny bit from their work to really try to assess what's being effective and what's not to move forward. So vultures is where the whole book began. I actually started working on the vulture decline here in South Asia like 10 years ago, before I ever remotely thought about writing a book. And so the vultures are in absolute dire crisis. About in the mid 90s, they literally started falling dead from trees. Nobody knew why. Very few people were even paying attention to the fact that they were falling dead from trees. And it took this whole kind of amazing conservation sleuthing effort from scientists all over the world to figure out even what was going on. And they finally isolated it, and it was just this very innocuous painkiller, an NSAID called diclofenac. Humans have taken it for decades, and then in the 90s, farmers started giving it to their cow. So if you have a cow that's kind of limping its way and you want to get it through harvest, and you give it a shot of diclofenac, it's a very happy cow, it forgets its foot hurts, and gets through harvest, but maybe it's really sick, and then it dies. And if that animal has diclofenac in its body, the vultures would come and feed on it, and they just have zero tolerance for it. They have renal failure, and they die. So you caught this, that kind of scenario caused a 97 to 99% collapse in one decade. It was the fastest avian decline in the history of humankind. So what does that mean? What happens when you once had so many vultures that you didn't even know how to count them? You know, nobody even paid any attention to them. And then they were just gone. And they had served forever as the garbage collectors of South Asia, literally going out, cleaning up the dead in the place where they had died, so farmers wouldn't even have to deal with it. The vultures would just go and clean it up. So I went trying to figure out what are the ramifications of this. I traveled all over North India. This was, you know, because I'd worked on the story for so long, I went back to places repeatedly. I spent time in the field with conservation biologists who were studying the last remaining nests. So we would be up the Chambal River, you know, looking at nest sites where there used to be 100 and there would be 4 birds. So they were documenting documenting the decline to just try to gather whatever information they could. And I asked, this is Munir, I asked him what he, like, what happens when you have this ecological niche that's just vacated? And I warn you, there's a couple slightly graphic images coming up, but what happens is that niche, by all appearances, there's no way to absolutely prove this, but as the vultures population crashed, feral dog populations have gone up. And you've got now dogs, I mean, I'm reading, this morning's paper was talking about the impact of leopard populations following, the dogs are a food source for the leopards, and leopards, vultures don't like people. They just don't like us. You know, they want nothing to do. The biggest defense mechanism is they vomit and they fly away, which is great. We don't want to go near them, right? But they don't want to go near us either. And they only are scavenging. They're only eating dead stuff. Dogs, totally different. Dogs are predatory. They do kill. They attack children. I wrote about a girl who had been a young, I forget, boy or girl that had been killed here in Bengaluru. But it's they are a huge problem. You also have to deal with all that dead stuff that the vultures used to go and consume. So I went to, in western Rajasthan, to Bikaner, a carcass dump, where now they collect the dead from this whole region. And it's basically like a feeding ground for feral dogs. I also went up to Haryana, where they've captured the last remaining birds that they could get their hands on. And they're actually doing captive breeding of vultures, which is something that had never been done before. They're using a combination of natural breeding techniques. They're using incubators. Here, she's showing me the size of a little vulture chick when it comes hatched. And then they've got vultures in aviaries, and they're basically just waiting very patiently until they can be absolutely sure that diclofenac is removed from the environment. And it's getting closer and closer. India was very proactive about banning the veterinary use of diclofenac back in 2006, but the black market has been just too easy to get the human formulation and still give it to livestock. There have been some indications in the past year that they're like reducing the vial size, and maybe that'll make it harder for vets to want to use this drug on their cattle anymore, but right now they have not been able to release the birds. So their birds are patiently waiting, and the biologists are working very hard with very thankless work to try to continue to raise money to feed vultures. It's not the same as tigers. And then, this is just so fascinating, it had this whole religious implication. The Parsis, mostly based up in Mumbai, for thousands of years have laid out their dead on top of towers of silence for the vultures to eat. They've done this since the times of Herodotus, who documented it, and they just don't believe in cremation, they don't believe in burial. Those elements are sacred and you can't pollute it with a dead body. So the sky burial was a perfect way of disposing of their dead, until the vultures didn't come anymore, and then the whole system just came to a grinding halt. What they're trying to do now is they have solar collectors aimed at the towers in hopes of sort of desiccating the bodies. Mixed results on whether this is working or not. I imagine that it's really not working very well during monsoon season. And then it's caused a schism within the Parsi community, because some Parsis, like this woman Dunbaria, are just saying, we need to adapt. The vultures are gone. We need to allow burial. We need to allow cremation into our rituals and allow the prayers to take place as they should in the fire temples. We can't ban this anymore. Like, we have to adapt. So all these questions of adaptation, both for the vultures as a species and for human communities to this changing world. And the vulture story was also a story just about unintended consequences, how much we need to recognize that that is such a part of these ecological problems. There's no way that anybody could have predicted that the vultures would decline because of this drug being given to goats and cattle. There's no way. So just a dose of humility, perhaps, in terms of thinking about the effects that our actions take on our surroundings, and then how those changes come back to us. And then the last section was ether. So this is Akasha. This is like the space between spaces. And I wanted to, I originally went into this planning on talking about population specifically. I decided to go to Bihar, which is one of the places with some of the youngest brides and some of the highest birth rates, to see what efforts were being taken to try to change that. And I met, you know, the girl in red is 14, 15 years old. When I met her, she was already married for a year. there were other girls who were really seeking some way to maybe change the paths of their lives. And then I ended up focusing in on the work of Pathfinder International, which is an NGO, and specifically the teacher trainer, Pinky Kumari, who was 30 years old when I met her and basically had this amazing story of her own kind of fight with her parents to let her stay in school and delay her marriage and not get married off at 16. She was amazingly successful, went on to get a master's at Leeds, and continues to work in reproductive and sexual health training. As I was working on that part of the story, was right around the same time of the gang rape in Delhi. There was a lot of just talking about women's autonomy and girls' autonomy, just to not only have their lives, let them be able to stay in school and be educated, but also to just be safe, both in their homes and on the streets. So Pathfinder was doing really basic, simple things. They were training teenagers with a 3-day reproductive and sexual health training. Super basic stuff. What is menstruation? Why you should stay in school until the legal age of 18 to get married? What happens, what physiologically happens in the body in terms of developing in those few years? How to talk about birth control with their partners, how to decide how many children to have, how to space out those children. And, you know, I went to Bihar thinking this was going to be a really, really tough story to report, but I ended up being really encouraged by the girls that I met there. They were just, seemed like this small bit of knowledge for them, gave them an autonomy and a voice that they didn't have in other respects. It was almost as though by teaching them about their own bodies, they were learning how to speak up in other realms of their life as well. Some of the girls that I met had just gone on to teach, you know, took what they learned and went to their villagers and were teaching other kids as well. So it ended up being a really pretty hopeful story. So to wrap it up, I mean, I'm not a policymaker. I'm not an eco-entrepreneur. I'm not a scientist. I don't work in development. But so many of the people that I met didn't either. They were just doing things in their own lives that were transforming both their own trajectory as well as the state of their own landscape. And I just wonder what would happen if there was support for a lot of these grassroots efforts coming from the top down as well. Because right now that seems like that's what's missing, is that there's like all these isolated little efforts happening and people feel like they're pushing stones uphill. And so maybe I'll just read a little bit from the conclusion and then we can open it up to questions. As I traveled across the subcontinent, I asked nearly everyone I met, "Do you have hope?" I asked the biologists Munir and Patrick as we sipped tea along the shores of a lake in Rajasthan. I asked activists I met in Bengaluru and epidemiologists from Chennai. I asked Pinky and Binod in the car heading back to Patna, and farmers as we sat in fields in Punjab. A few offered an unequivocal yes, others a resounding no, but most often I received halting replies as people desperately tried to fashion optimistic but not always convincing answers. In Rajasthan, something changed. Kanhi and I were standing at the top of the hill behind his house, overlooking the Baunta Valley, verdant and invigorated by small-scale waterworks. There, under a cerulean sky, I realized I'd been asking the wrong question all along. I was using hope as a noun when I should have been using it as a verb, as something active and ongoing. I was using hope as a thing to be possessed, something you either had or lacked. Instead of asking, "Do you have hope?" I should have been asking, "Do you hope?" We hope for a bountiful harvest from a Punjabi field that leaves the soil and water intact. He hopes for a vulture's survival as he lets it loose from his hands into the wild. She hopes for a future she begins to imagine on a cloudy afternoon in a one-room schoolhouse in Bihar. To hope is also to act, and now is India's time for action. Now is the moment to build a new economy that cultivates the country's people and also safeguards its irreplaceable natural resources. At this moment, India must decide what her future will be. Two paths present themselves as her development efforts advance. Macro is the way of the past and of the West. In the 20th century Europe and North America, to develop was to go big. Rapid advancements in technology enabled humans to build ever more complicated systems to create energy, siphon water, and grow food. Mega dams grew to such epic proportions that they drew tourists. Big concrete, big steel. We split atoms to release previously unimaginable amounts of energy. Industrialization, not limited to manufacturing, became the model by which to raise meat and grow crops. These efforts were incredibly productive. They also came at untold collateral cost to the environment and human communities, and they have proven unsustainable over the long term. India could follow the West down this well-worn path of the big, wrenching every last resource from the ecosystems of South Asia and giving back nothing. It takes little imagination to envision such a future. Overhead will be the blackened skies of England in the mid-19th century, or America soon after, or Beijing yesterday, or New Delhi today. This addiction to the big will result in more dead zones where the rivers meet the seas, like the ones in the Gulf of Mexico and the Baltic Sea, caused from the agricultural runoff and pollution. Indian rivers will run so thick with effluent that they burst into flames, as Ohio's Cuyahoga River repeatedly did. Or India could choose the other path. Just as she created her own form of democracy, intrinsically Indian and not just a replica of the Western model, she could create her own way to develop her people and resources. Growth could be guided by environmental self-rule. Call it eco-swaraj, something only a few developed countries have tried on a large scale and that is nearly non-existent in the developing world. Imagine an India in which innovation comes from the micro, where communities of the grassroots decide what they need and how to get it. A bottom-up approach to India's environmental crises can feed people without depleting the soil, draw water from wells without diminishing aquifers or displacing communities, fuel India's growing energy needs without wrecking the environment. The technology exists and is continually improving, and coupled with the traditional knowledge that remains, could be transformative. I think this is what India is just poised to be, the place that creates a whole new model of development for the 21st century that's based on techniques that are more sustainable than those of the past. I believe that it's not a mutually exclusive method that you can develop, you know, because we want to bring those development labs, we want to fill them, right? So there's a way to do that, but it doesn't need to involve how it's been done in the past. India is a perfect place for this model to emerge. It's a place of small farmers, of small shopkeepers. You haven't already, because of those development lags, there's an element of a blank slate there in terms of deciding how you want to set it up for the future. You're not already locked into absolutely needing a car to get everywhere. In the US, you can't exist in most parts of the country without having a vehicle, private vehicle, and all of the traffic that involves. India is heading in that direction, but you are not locked into it yet. There's still time to change that trajectory. This quote, India must view the era of the green economy not as a threat to its development plans. Instead, it must be viewed as an opportunity to build and demonstrate technological capability to the world. I think it's easy to forget that India created a whole new model for revolution here. India did this not that long ago. The world had never seen a non-violent revolution that had gotten colonial powers out of their backyard. And it happened here in India, and it became a model for the US for the civil rights movement 20 years later. So the idea that right now India is poised to do this and could become the model not only for how India develops, but how China continues to develop, how Africa develops, how US decides to do infrastructure 2.0 now that our infrastructure that we put in 80 years ago is slowly crumbling. So I think that there's a lot of hope for what could happen here in India, and that there's a lot that the rest of the world could learn and that India could benefit from heading in that direction. Whether it happens remains to be seen. So thank you, and I welcome your questions. Here, we have a microphone here.
Hello.
Hi, perfect.
Meera, how did you plan your itinerary, and how do you decide what is elementary in a traditional way, and how do you see the complexities? Like you've taken the example of Parsis, and the Tower of Silence, you know. They have decided to do away with the Tower of Silence.
They still have the Towers of Silence. They're still there in Mumbai. They're still operating every day. So the towers are there. They're using solar collectors as an attempt to try to desiccate.
So did you see the transition? Were they going in for incineration and all that?
Many Parsis are going towards cremation and burial. The big sticking point is that those who choose to do that are not allowed to have the prayers and the final rituals happen at the fire temples there at the Dungarwadi at Malabar Hill, which is the main area where the towers are. So it's an entire system. If you are a Parsi and someone in your family dies, you call Malabar Hill and the whole system is there in place. If you want to choose to cremate or bury your family member, then you have to do everything yourself. You're sort of locked out of the main Parsi system. So that's where, and that's just coming from the Parsi Panchayat, who wants to, you know, there's orthodox beliefs within that system that they just do not want to allow it. So there's some renegade priests that are willing to do these, but they're not allowed to do them in the temples there at Malabar Hill. So it's causing a schism within the community because some people feel like they have to adapt and other ones are trying to figure out if there's some other way. There have been talks of building an aviary with the Tower of Silence in the middle and the vultures would be inside, but from all the scientists and biologists I talked to, it would be dooming those vultures to death because diclofenac is in hundreds of formulations that humans take, and it's very likely that a human body would also have those chemicals in it that would kill the vultures. I want some good student questions. Is this going to be easy? Can we do this? It's not going to be easy, even if we can.
I know this wasn't strictly your focus, so you know, putting you a little bit outside maybe of... I'm trying to think, you know, the usual question of scale and how one takes so many examples, of which there are many, and you've seen yourself and there are many others, and how one really builds a politics, for lack of a better word, of this kind of a thing. You know, so eco-swaraj is basically a political idea. It's not a technical idea.
Right.
So it's not about knowing how to do things, which we do know, but about changing something else, somewhere else, you know, whether it's Delhi or Bangalore, you know, in terms of the political thinking. So did you ever talk to people about this or? You know?
Yeah, I mean, that is the biggest conundrum of the whole thing because the efforts are there. And I think it's good to remember that Margaret Mead quote about it doesn't take, you know, 75% of the population rushing out to the streets. It takes a small portion of engaged people who are basically expressing the sentiments of all those other people who just don't have time to make it to the rally, right? So getting those people out, it tips the needle, and we've seen this time and time again everywhere. And so that is what gives me hope. I get really, I mean, especially as I've been talking about this book in India for over a month now, and I think this is my fourth city, and the recurring topic of corruption, of having good laws on paper that are not implemented or enforced is a recurring theme. And that is, India has a huge battle around that. But then the follow-up that always comes up in that conversation is that everybody's part of it. I mean, this is a democracy, right? So whoever's up there has been voted in, even if we don't like our choices. Lord knows we're looking at Trump in the US, so I'm speaking, we're all in this together. The corruption part, you know, people say, well, I paid the cops off too so that I didn't have to be bothered to go pick up my license the next day. So recognizing the participation, and I think that is something that that is the place where there's the most room for change to happen. The fact that there's been a huge growth in the middle class in India over the past generation, that has been the part that has benefited from a lot of these economic reforms. Figure out what's going to happen with that freedom that has been bought of not having to worry about daily needs anymore. Is it going to go to towards the cool latest gadget or game, or is it going to go towards becoming a more engaged citizen within your town and country? Because it doesn't take much. We have seen evidence that, you know, people just pushing for. When I was doing that organic farming in my 20s, my parents thought I was crazy. Everybody thought I was crazy, living on this farm, organic, whatever. Nobody had even heard of it. It was like this hippie thing left over from the 70s. And by the time I go to New York City in 2003 for grad school, every little corner store has organic milk. And people are talking about where their food comes from. And they're talking about how far it's traveled before it's gotten to their plate. And they want to know the name of their chicken before they eat it, right? So this change can happen in a very short order, like when you least expect it. And that's, as much as the stories of corruption and political lags and just feeling like you're going one step up and two steps back or five steps back, there are all these moments that we can think of that show that we are moving in towards more of these efforts and more connection. It's just a matter of whether we can turn it into something that's more than just this small scale effort. Oh, come on, one student. Good.
Yeah, hi, Meera. My question is, when most maximum percentage of you, the Indian population is below poverty line, and many of us are hand to mouth, how do you see this concept of organic farming coming in? Because it seems as an elitist concept to Indians. So how do you see it happening in the near future?
I mean, that's where I got encouragement from the farmers that I was meeting. I mean, I think a big tricky thing with organic is it costs more to buy. Right now, I don't fully understand why it costs more. There is more human labor involved in creating it, but you also are not spending money on all those the proprietary seeds and all the inputs. So somehow the economics of that should work out. But even if the middle class are the only ones who can afford to buy organic, it's still supporting that entire economy of the farmers who are working the land. So that's got huge health impacts for the laborers, for the farmers. You know, there was one study that said organic food, you know, an organic carrot has no more vitamins than a non-organic carrot. And I feel like that is not really part of the equation. I'm thinking about the poor laborer who's spending all day growing that carrot and the chemicals that they're exposed to and the water that they have, you know, their daily lives. So there's this whole, again, thinking about it in an ecosystem approach. You know, it's like your carrot isn't just the carrot that you're putting in your body and it's just you and the carrot. No, you have this entire ecosystem around growing that one bit of food. And so I think for some of the farmers that I met, they were doing it because they wanted to get out from the cycle of debt, of constantly being told that the next product that they would buy from a corporation. The tricky thing, and I can go more into the science if you want, but a lot of these methods of the Green Revolution work to a point and then they stop working. And then you need to do the next thing to combat that problem that stemmed from the first. So you've got this endless cycle of trying to like solve the next problem, usually with something that you need to buy from the company that gave you the problem in the first place. So that was a real impetus for a lot of the farmers that I met of just like, I don't want to be in this anymore. I want to like create soil and an ecosystem here on my farm that works for the long term without constantly doing the inputs. I mean, I don't dive into the whole genetically modified issue, but genetically modified cotton deals with boll weevil. That's one pest, one major, major pest, granted, but it's one pest. So when you get rid of that, again, the whole nature abhors a vacuum, like the vultures, you know, something else comes in, and it comes in very short order. I mean, there was one study that came out of Cornell looking at BT cotton in China, and they found, you know, like 3 years into growing this cotton, that the farmers were making like way more money and they were spraying chemicals way less because the GM dealt with the pests. But 7 years into it, which is like a little blink of an eye in terms of agriculture sustainability forever and ever for generations, 7 years into using this new seed, the farmers were spraying the same amount as with the non-genetically modified seeds, because again, the pests had just adapted very quickly. You know, the strongest ones survived and they go on to make more. And the farmers were losing money because they were paying for these seeds that cost three times as much as the non-genetically modified seeds. So it's just this endless race. And I mean, the corporate influence is a big part of it. It's like eight companies control 2/3 of the proprietary seed market. They control 2/3 of the fertilizers and pesticides. It's a huge, huge amount of money. When farmers decide not to buy into that system, they are losing out on that money. They're losing market share. An encouraging thing is I was in Oklahoma back in September, which is kind of our Punjab, like our heartland of America. This is not a radical, progressive, hippie place at all. And yet they were incorporating some of these techniques that I saw farmers in Punjab using, like no-till farming and really looking at water conservation. And they were doing it because they saw that they were about to enter another dust bowl. Like the environmental situation was so dire. The soil was dead. Literally, when soil dies, it can't, there's nothing active alive keeping it whole. So they'd get pouring rains. Remember that flooding drought cycle? That was what was happening in Oklahoma. Pouring rains, and it would be like it was hitting concrete. It would never permeate the soil because the soil was just like nothing left but clay, dust bowl. Like before it blows away, it's just like rock. And so they were incorporating a very large percentage of the farmers across the state were starting to incorporate some of these methods because it was in their interest. And then the corporate entities in that area were like, oh, we're coming up with this new hocus pocus stuff. It's microorganisms you can add to the soil. So they were like heading towards the organic natural, trying to figure out how they can get into that market. Bless them, I think that's great. If they are heading into that and it makes more sustainable soil, then that might be a good way to go. But so I feel like there's evidence that even those hand-to-mouth farmers would really benefit from this, not only on the personal health level, but even on the economic level. There's no way to absolutely say that the farmer suicides are just like directly linked to the economic, the expenditures that they have to make, but it's part of the equation, definitely. I think that's obvious. Thanks, good question. Over here.
Hi.
Hi.
So I just wanted to ask you, how difficult was it to see the transition from chemical farming to organic farming? I don't think so. It's very, I think most of the farmers are adapted to chemical farming. And then is it a community level decision which they take to switch over to organic farming? I mean, it's really difficult for one farmer to switch over to organic farming. I mean, how did that transition take place?
Yeah, because India is a land of mostly small farmers, most people were doing it on an individual level. In places like Kheti Barasat Mission is based in Jaitu in Punjab, and that area, because of that NGO training, so many people there had a much higher concentration of farmers who were doing it. But it still was farm by farm people deciding. So I was sitting there, you know, talking to one farmer, and that picture of the guy who was spraying chemicals, as I'm interviewing the organic farmer, you know, 50 feet away on the next farm, but it's right there, they're spraying chemicals. So there's that part of the equation, but it definitely seemed to be radiating out as farmers tried it. Then other farmers could just be like, well, I'm not ready to take that gamble, but I'm willing to watch him and see how he does. And I definitely met farmers who were doing that. And then also what Gaurav Singh was doing was very common. Don't do all of the lands at once. Transition slowly so that it's not, because it takes time for the soil to build back up and to get it back to a place that is gonna be getting you the yields that are gonna approximate those that you were getting with the inputs. So doing that slowly is also another excellent way for that to happen. Very interestingly, he was totally keeping the organic produce for his own family. All the rest was going to market. Like, so where the farmers are choosing, like what they're choosing to eat and feed their families shows, I think it reveals a lot about how they feel about these systems. And then, was there anything else you asked? I think that was it, yeah. Those are, India is mostly small farmers. One farmer I read about who had 130 acres, seventh generation Punjabi farmer, pretty well off. He went to one of these Kativarasat missions and just to oblige a friend. And it was like a religious conversion for him. He's just like, oh my God, why am I using all these things? And he stopped overnight. But he had the economic resources to ride him through that, because it took him, I was like, oh, how did that go? And he was like, oh, it was terrible. But he was able to ride that economically because he had the savings to do that and the power to do that. Most small farmers can't afford to make that kind of like blunt transition in that respect. So it's very easy. It's 3:20, should one more or any? Okay, good.
Hi, thanks for this brilliant talk. And we see all these local initiatives being happening from society level, as in mostly people coming up on their own and trying these things. When you see the role of the state in something like Green Revolution, it was immense. But when you talk about these initiatives, you see very little, even the ideology of the Indian state, support these systems. It's very, very weak. And somewhere I feel they don't even feel, because what we saw going out at the global level is America has done it and we'll do it again. We'll show it to them that we can do it.
Right.
So when you see these things floating around, how do you relate them?
That's again where that political thing comes in, because the corporate influence is really huge. I mean, Rachel Carson, when she wrote about Silent Spring, she's like, 99% of the entomologists, this is 1960s US, were studying chemical ways to deal with pests instead of like understanding how pests work and how their ecosystems work and what might naturally work to fight them or to encourage the good pests and not the bad ones. So it's an old story that the energy goes towards these things. I mean, a very good metaphor I imagine is like we spend a lot of time and money and resources globally to try to figure out how to cure cancer. There's almost no talk about how to prevent cancer in the first place, right? Nobody wants to go through cancer treatment. How do we prevent this? How do we figure out root causes of some of these problems and try to address those? But there's not much money to be made in that. I'm not an anti-capitalist per se, but it's just frustrating because there's just so much influence that comes from those economic systems. And government entities benefit from that. So, how that again takes civilian engagement in saying we don't want to head in that direction, we want to head in this direction. We want to vote for you if you head in this direction. We supporting those endeavors either as a consumer or as a voter to make those efforts bear fruit, because there's a lot of opposition coming from really powerful forces that are, in this case, often outside of India. I mean, I was really struck by as I was reporting on this, I totally understood and it made sense that India wanted to become food independent. Like, India was so dependent on these shiploads of food coming in when it became its own nation. Like, that totally made sense. But then as I reported on this, I'm like, has India just traded that its dependency on these boatloads of grain for boatloads of technology? Seeds of all the inputs, like most of that stuff is coming from Western companies. It's not coming indigenously. It's not money that's staying in the country, even in the country, let alone in a region. It's so have you just traded one dependence for another one? I think that's part of the equation too.
Did you happen to talk to any of the elected local representatives, and what was their stand on these issues?
Some of them. I mean, there was definitely, I mean, even Vinod Gianni, the farmer who had 130 acres, he was involved with politics and everything like that. So there were some people that were already bridging that divide, but for the most part, I mean, at one point I talked to Navdanya up in Uttarakhand, and the fellow there said, when I asked him about the government, because I was hearing at that point, this is happy news that Sikkim has gone totally organic. That was like in the works when I was working on this book, and it just happened, since I landed in India 3 weeks ago. Amazing, by the way, like that's not even being discussed in the US, of like an entirely organic state. It's not Punjab, it's not the breadbasket, but still it's really encouraging. But I was asking him at Navdanya about these efforts. I'm like, what's going on? I'm hearing, entire states are talking about going organic, but then I hear they're gonna bring the Green Revolution to Bihar. Like, what's going on here? And he's like, yeah, the government wants to be in two boats at the same time. And that is what I seem to sense the most from the research and the interviews that I was doing, is that there is, and Prime Minister Modi definitely seems to be doing that across the board. Energy, for example, building coal-fired power plants at the same time as promoting renewables, like maybe that needs to happen in terms of this like all energy sources thing, but also if you redirected all of that energy towards renewables and really tried to do what like Germany did or is doing, something altogether new could happen.
Thank you for the talk. Can you briefly reflect on how you found your cases? How you chose the cases you chose? And also, were there any moments of, you know, bafflement and opacity, and I don't quite understand this, in terms of what you were trying to grasp by way of an instructive or the constructive in, engagement?
Great. In terms of finding the stories, I mean, the vultures was already had been there, and then the framework, the idea of using the Panchamahabhuta as like a framework for it came pretty early on in the process, so that helped me like zoom in. I'm like, okay, what water stories are happening? And I was looking for, I was trying to find hopeful, positive stories. I mean, I could have written an entire book about mega dams and farmer suicides, and wouldn't that have been fun to report and read? No. So I was trying to find something like, we're deluged with the bad news every day in our newspaper. That's what the newspaper is going to give you. So I was trying to seek out the stories that were maybe offered a hint of some sort of other alternative. So that was part of the guidance. And then geographically, I was trying to get a good representation of the country. I didn't want to just all be in one area. I'd ended up focusing on Punjab and Rajasthan in that area a little bit more, it seemed like. But I tried to just because the country is so diverse, I wanted to try to get representation in that respect. So that Google map that I showed you in the beginning, if I showed you the one that was the research one that had like every possible story, it's just plastered. And then it was a question of sometimes just access. Some stories seemed really great, but it seemed like the contacts were not there, or it was just going to be too difficult to report on some level. And even many places that I went and reported on, again, just didn't make it into the book because I was trying to not write an encyclopedia of every farmer that I met. I mean, I interviewed hundreds of people for this book, and it's really just a couple dozen that actually make it in. So I would just try to find the stories that seemed to, you know, one farmer who represented what I met five farmers who were telling me, but this one story, he had the most compelling stories about why he was doing what he was doing, and so that would be the one that would make the cut. I actually handed in a manuscript that was like way too long. Wonderful editors helped me condense it into something more readable. Did you ask a second question too? What was it? Was I baffled? Constantly baffled. I mean, I went from NGO work, like the reason why I shifted to journalism was because I was doing more and more writing for the NGOs, and I realized that, you know, you have an NGO, you have a mission statement, and you need to stick to that mission statement. It's kind of like going back to the funding question where as I was doing that work, I realized like all of these stories are way more complicated than I'm allowed to talk about them. And that was really my personal driving reason for going into journalism and yet still covering the exact same types of topics I've been doing since I was 19. And the cook stove is a perfect example where it's like, I loved those cook stoves. I built them, I cooked with them. They're totally cool, but the reality of what that's like, especially if that is your every single meal stove, becomes something totally different. So lots of times I was baffled as I was doing the stories, like I just found unexpected things, which is what I love about the work of a journalist, is that you just have to be open to that, and that's part of the story, is that the answers are never, none of these, you know, in some ways I'm pushing something in the conclusion, but I know it's not as easy as just digging a couple dams and switching to organic on a little farm. Like, these are huge, huge complicated issues. There's no easy answer for any of them. But I think more than anything, I think I'm advocating for just a slight shift in perspective about what direction we could go and what direction, how that might be able to move in one direction versus another.
Thank you, Meera. Please join me in thanking Meera for a lovely talk.
Thank you. And there's books outside, and I'm here. I have some time before I have to race off, so if anybody else has any questions, feel free to come up.
Welcome, everyone. Delighted to welcome Meera Subramanian, our speaker this afternoon. Thanks to all of you who have taken time off Unmukt to come, although this is part of Unmukt, as you will have noticed on your program schedule. It's a very sly tactic on my side, I think. Meera Subramanian is a journalist who's written in very distinguished journals. She writes on a variety of issues concerning nature, culture, and faith. She also edits an online literary nonfiction journal called Killing the Buddha. I invite Meera to give a talk.
Thank you. Let's see, how does this sound? Is that mic working? Yeah, can you hear him back? Okay. Great, thank you for having me. It's really great to be here. I will do maybe about 45 minutes of just talking about this book, Elemental India, which is about stories from across the country of people who are facing some major environmental challenges in their own backyard with micro solutions, both working and challenging both. So I'll share some photos and some drawings, and we'll have plenty of time for questions. But I'd love to know who I'm talking to. So how many students are here? Okay. And then faculty, NGOs, anybody else? Okay, great. And the students are coming from the development side, is that the interest? Okay, good. So start thinking about questions. But first, let's talk about how I even came to write this book. So my name, Meera Subramanian, sounds like I shouldn't be speaking the way that I am. And so part of that reason is the backstory of that my father is from Madras, from Chennai, and my mother's from Chicago. So I was born and raised in the US, but my dad really maintained a strong connection to his family in Chennai. So this was my very first visit. I'm 18 months old in 1972, there in my mom's arms, probably slightly overwhelmed. My brother looks terrified. So every few years, we would come to India to visit family and go to weddings and things. And each time I came, I was changing as I grew up, but also India was just going through major transformations, a very quickly transforming country. So I would see this in 1980. This is the village where my father was born. And then by the 90s, you had the National Stock Exchange in Mumbai. So especially in the 90s, when economic reforms kicked in, India really entered a whole new generation that you are a direct result of. In that same time frame, to go back to a little bit of what I was going through in the 90s, I graduated from undergraduate work and undergraduate school in anthropology, but I was really interested and passionate about environmental issues. So I had just gone directly into the NGO field. I was working, actually most of my 20s, I was in a small farm in rural Oregon. We were growing organic vegetables and cooking over an open fire with these fuel-efficient wood cook stoves and building homes and heating our homes with wood that we gathered from the forest around us. So I was in some ways heading back towards my father's village in terms of lifestyle. And India, in the meanwhile, was sort of racing in the other direction of becoming more and more developed. But interestingly, now that it's been a full generation of this form of development, the lags are becoming really apparent. And when you look hard at the numbers of Indians that are lacking basic electricity, 25%. Two-thirds are still cooking over an open fire for at least part of their daily needs. More than half don't have access to clean water. So My question, you know, guiding me during my 20s and then as I shifted into journalism in my 30s, was how to address these questions of how to get those resources that everyone needs, all 7 billion of us on this planet, a fifth of them here in India, how do we get those basic needs fulfilled for people without wrecking the environment further? We're already dealing with a lot of environmental degradation in India and elsewhere. So those questions of how to get electricity to people, how to get people off of biomass and onto cleaner fuels, how to do those things in a sustainable fashion that doesn't further compromise the environment. So that was kind of the driving question about the book. So I took those interests from my 20s in the NGO work and the past 10 years as a journalist addressing those same questions that grew into basically the idea of this book. This is my first book, so in order to kind of be able to wrap my head around it and also to make it something that readers would enjoy reading, I decided to use the framework of the Panchamahabhuta, the idea of the five elements, to tell five different narrative stories from around the country. So that meant that I went to, I covered a lot of ground in the process of reporting for this. It was about 3 years of working on the book. I came here as multiple trips that were months long. I came as a Fulbright Nehru Fellowship, really helped me get a chunk of the reporting done. And I covered a large swath of the country and yet still barely skimmed the surface. It's an amazingly diverse, huge place. And so, but I did come here to Bangalore. I was down in Karnataka, and I'll talk a little bit about that. So just briefly, I'm gonna go through the five elements. I'll maybe pause and read from a couple sections here and there. Starting off with Earth. So Earth, the question of feeding India's population was very, very relevant when India became independent. At that point, India was very dependent on imports for a lot of its food and was very cognizant of the fact that there was a growing population. So I focus mostly, I'll talk a little bit about Karnataka, but where I went to farms there, but I'll primarily focus on Punjab. So this is the breadbasket of the nation. Right, almost half of the rice comes from here. Huge amounts of wheat and cotton come from here. And so this area, as being a really fertile area, was a target for the Green Revolution. And so in the 60s and 70s, this began, and this was basically a technique for modern agriculture that used a combination of high yield seeds and high inputs of fertilizers and insecticides and pesticides, along with high quantities of water. And so the chemicals now, 40 years into using Green Revolution techniques, the chemicals are just literally everywhere. They're used in, you know, they're turned into bags to carry your tiffin to work. They were sadly in the vegetable oil container that was used for a Bihari midday meal, where they used an old insecticide container to put vegetable oil in, and two dozen children died in the process. So these chemicals are literally everywhere. Permeated the soil and the groundwater. They're in our very cells, just with the food that we're getting, as well as the farmers that are working directly with these chemicals. And so the Green Revolution in many ways did work. Yields go really high up when you add all those inputs initially, but what happens over the long term is that those yields then stagnate, sometimes they even drop, and all of the environmental and health costs start coming due. So cancer rates in Punjab are higher than they are anywhere else in the country. There's a cancer train that travels to Rajasthan for treatment on a daily basis. And to understand just the concentration of the chemical use in this area, Punjab is just like less than 2% of the landmass of India. It's a very small area, yet about 17% of the pesticides are used in this one state. So we're talking about really high concentrations. And so the question is, how do you address this? How do you get food to people in a more sustainable way that isn't so harmful for the farmers who are working it, for the consumers who are eating the food grown on it, and for the soil? So I focused on the work of Kheti Virasat Mission, which is working on teaching farmers that are there in Punjab more natural organic techniques. And each chapter, I would try to have the overarching question of the book was there about how do we do this sustainably, live on the earth, and get everything we need. The chapter in this question was like, would India starve? You know, this is like a very legitimate question. The the famines in Bengal killed millions in the 1940s. This is very recent history. So this question is very relevant. You know, maybe the Green Revolution has to happen in order to get the food to people, and all this other stuff is just collateral damage we have to live with. But I went out seeking the farmers who might be able to tell me something different. When I posed this question to farmers, you know, would India starve if it switched to organic? I got the whole spectrum of answers. Two brothers, the one with the scarf over his head, said yes, India would starve. You consumers, you don't care what you're eating. You just want it to be cheap. That's all you care about. He used the chemicals on his half of the family lands. And then the other brother with the turban, he had had health problems, and he felt like they were coming partly from these chemicals that were being used. And he went natural on his half of the family lands. So I would get this, you know, cup half full, cup half empty, quite a bit. One farmer I met was Gora Singh. He was very typical. India is a land of small farmers, so Gora has 5 acres, very typical. And he was doing a slow transition. So just in case things weren't working with this new fangled organic stuff, he was switching 2 acres to organic so far. He'd been having really positive results. He was watching his soil come back to life. He was using a combination of all these different techniques. He was using traditional jivamruta, like a combination of cow urine and manure and bio, like neem plants for insecticides, natural insecticides, and using crop rotation. So he would plant legumes that help bring nitrogen to the soil before he would plant a heavy crop like corn that needed a lot of nitrogen. So he was just reintroducing a lot of techniques that that his grandfather used, you know. And when one way he described it, he said that, "I always used chemicals on my plants because I didn't know you couldn't." You know, he was the generation that had never known anything different. Usually I read a little section from about Gora, but because I'm here, I'm gonna read the section from Karnataka, just to bring us local. And I'll bring us right to Electronic City. Why not, right? Far from Punjab, I later stood on a corner in a place known as Electronic City on the outskirts of the southern city of Bengaluru. Who says Bangalore? Who says Bengaluru? Bangalore? Bangalore. I always seem to say the wrong one. I'll use Bangalore today. The city's rapid growth during the information technology boom made it the Silicon Valley of India, home of such IT giants as Infosys and Wipro, and development had spilled over into the once quiet countryside. When I arrived in 2013, Electronic City felt like it had fallen from the sky and the dust was still settling. Building cranes dominated the emerging skyline, adding layers to freshly poured concrete buildings surrounded by bamboo scaffolding. Cows trotted down the street, startled by the passing of corporate buses where there had once been bullock carts. My cousin Pavitra was traveling with me, and we were bound for an organic farm of a very different sort than what I'd seen in Punjab, one that reflected a new India as buzzing as Bengaluru. A silver Tata pickup truck stopped in front of us, and Namit MVS, who went simply by Namit, stepped out to greet us. The owner of First Agro and a first-generation farmer, he instantly reminded me of Hashish Ahuja, which was one of the farmers I'd met up in Punjab. He was tall and fit, a man who left India for North America, where he flew as a pilot in Canada for 8 years, and then had returned to India to reinvent himself as a modern farmer. He wore a white-collared t-shirt, periwinkle shorts, hiking boots, and a crooked smile with a broken front tooth. At 35 years old, Namit had ambitions that far exceeded those of coffee cup-toting Ashish. Namit wanted to take what he called zero pesticides, certified to international standards, gourmet and epicurean, to scale. First Agro's objective was to go big and to do it fast, without any agrochemicals. Namit and his brother Naveen founded the company to bring high-end organic produce and fruit to the growing Indian elite market. So he was raised like all over the world, Singapore, Japan, they traveled all over. And so he and his brother, who actually is still based in Japan, bought 45 acres here in Mysore district, and they had started this farm back in 2013. He said, "I don't know if this is gonna work. I figure either way will be a textbook case. Either this is how you do it, or this is how you don't." So we drove from Bangalore down 3 hours to the farm. Namit did not hail from a lineage of agriculturalists. He learned to farm, he said, from 800 hours of YouTube education. He passed the enology glean to his workers each time he circled the farm, prune the rows of beefsteak tomatoes to fight the verticillium wilt that was making the green forms stunted in comparison to their compatriots on either side. Set up the small tractor to run a pump spray to spray neem oil on cucumbers that were afflicted with cucumber beetles, which lit up like sparks in the sunlight. Production and water efficiency were a high priority. All the fields were set with drip irrigation line, which conserves vast quantities of water and targets the moisture directly to the plant's roots. There were lines of San Marzano tomatoes with small mango trees planted among them. Volunteer basil plants occasionally stroked our ankles, permitted to grow wherever a stray seed had taken root. Fields of peppers contained 46 different varieties, and he filled my cupped hands with samples of Thai black bird's eye and Trinidadian bishop's crown, the colors and shapes a screaming reminder of the biodiversity lacking in an Indian cuisine that depends on one variety of green chili capsicum only, one variety of tomato, one variety of onion. There's a huge variation in cuisine across India, from the Mughal-influenced meat dishes of the north to the coconut-infused flavors of the southern coasts, but the variety of ingredients is limited, captured in the handful of green chilies tossed in your satchel after buying vegetables from any street vendor. So they, so I posed this question to Namit, what, you know, would India starve? We had gone back to, we toured his farm and then gone back to the main building. He had, I think there were like 8 puppies or something that he'd just gotten. He'd adopted all these dogs. There was tons of these puppies are running all over us. So I asked Namit, you know, would India starve if it transitioned to organic? Yes, he said without hesitating. We just can't produce the yields needed. It was the complete opposite of what Vinod Jani, another farmer in Punjab, had answered. Namit, though a cheerful enough fellow, was pessimistic about the possibility of organic reaching the masses of India's hungry. He thought India was heading for a disaster, maybe not in my lifetime, but in my grandchildren's, if I have them. There will be 2 billion people in India alone by then. Where will people live, let alone grow their food? It will all be imported. Unlike the farmers I had met in Punjab who saw their move to organic as a social good akin to fighting for political independence, Namit was in it for the money and for the food. An unabashed capitalist, he didn't embrace the adoption of pre-independence modes of agriculture. He shunned even the idea of using Jivamrutra. It's filled with unknown bacteria and fungi, he said, a completely non-standardized process. And he didn't rail much about corporate agribusiness. He wanted little to do with organic activism. He was reticent when I asked him about Vandana Shiva, but said she got one thing right. Control your seeds, he said, and you control your future. Even with the lack of diversity apparent at Indian produce markets, heirloom seeds, diverse and indigenous, still survived across India. As for genetically modified varieties, they didn't even warrant his attention. I don't believe in that shit, he said. Not because of health, but that they own it. I just ate that tomato. It's in my belly. You're gonna say that it's your property? What Namit cared about was making a good living and bringing food to people who cared about it. Don't wear the hippie hat, the communist hat, he said. Don't grow food to feel good. Self-help groups are fine, but make it a profitable business that feeds people. So this is one, you know, and this was the amazing thing about going out and reporting and asking people these questions and hearing what they said, is that you would get the full range of answers. Another farmer that I referred to said we could go organic overnight, no problem. So throughout the book, I tried to balance out these stories that I heard on the ground from people who were living these experiences day to day with science to figure out what they were experiencing had feasibility, really, on a larger scale. And what I found was kind of amazing was that in regards to organic agriculture, there's actually strong scientific evidence that this is possible to head in this direction. A big part of using green revolution techniques is that you're feeding the plant and you're also depending on high inputs of water. In Punjab, the water table is in free fall. A fifth of Indian wells are compromised. There's not any evidence that we can continue to extract at that rate. So thinking about how to incorporate things like what Namit is saying of drip irrigation, water conservation on that level, and then building the soil instead of relying on the inputs to feed the plant, you cultivate the soil so that it can grow strong plants. So, you know, Gwara Singh held out organic, some of the organic part of his soil, and he's like, smell this, it's alive. And the science backs that up. There's a place in Michigan that has been studying this exact thing about how much do you need to put chemical inputs in order to get the yield to feed people? And if you don't put the nitrogen fertilizer in, your yield with organic is 80% of what it is with so-called conventional, with the chemicals. So that's substantial. We need that fifth, we need that fifth of that quantity to feed people. But what they've found at this research center, studying this for a quarter of a century, is that you can reduce those inputs, maybe not totally, not purely organic, but really reduce them, and then incorporate the things that the more traditional farmers are doing, like the crop rotation and the manuring and composting and all of these things, and you get yields that are the same without all the runoff. A lot of the nitrogen that gets put on, some goes to the plant, and lots, 50% runs off into the water and causes all sorts of other problems. So finding these thresholds can be the key to doing this. Another way is through ideas like agroforestry, agroecology, looks at a farm as an entire system. Instead of just considering the plants and thinking of it as monocropping, which is the direction that most of this industrial agriculture goes, instead consider the whole farm as an ecosystem. So you're trying to keep inputs in, you're trying to have it be more of a circular economy within the farm environment. And they've done this on 35 million acres in Africa, and they found doubling of yields in under 10 years. Likewise, system of crop intensification, SCI, focuses more attention on individual plants. These methods have been studied since Madagascar 30 years ago, and studies right here from India and Bihar were showing like 86% higher yields in rice, like game-changing numbers. So all of these techniques are proving themselves scientifically and could be the way to answer these questions about how to grow food sustainably without compromising the soil and without compromising water and human health. So the evidence is there. Again, you're taking like the best of the old traditional knowledge from our grandfathers as well as what Namita is thinking of modern drip technology, all these modern devices as well. So that was agriculture. The second element took me was water. So that took me to Rajasthan. And I went to the Alwar district, where it's always been a very semi-arid landscape. It's never been a moist place. But 30, 40 years ago, the wells had just completely run dry. Livestock couldn't be supported, agriculture couldn't be supported, and the men literally had just left the region looking for work elsewhere. And then the work of Tarun Bharat Sangh, under the guidance originally of Rajendra Singh, started building just small johads, these small dams all across the landscape. And the idea is that you're just catching these very fleeting ephemeral monsoon rains that come and helping them pause along the landscape just enough behind these little dams to be able to percolate down and recharge those aquifers. Really basic, and again, tapping back into traditional methods of water collection that had been in evidence all across South Asia and in many respects had just been lost during the colonial period. So part of it was reviving it. I spent a lot of time with Kanahia in his village that had been, he got involved with this organization when he was 20, 25 years old, had been doing this for the past 20 years and had basically seen his village come back to life. And everywhere with climate change and just changing weather patterns, this alternation between drought and deluge, where the rains come in shorter periods time and fall harder and faster, makes systems like this even more relevant, because when you've got those really heavy rains, the water just rushes off and it's taking topsoil with it. So you've got erosion combined with lack of water and you're just alternating between flooding and drought. Systems like this help, again, finding that threshold, finding that moderation point to try to bring those two places together. So this is Kanahia's village, and it had basically come back to life. These lands that we're looking at here in this photo were barren 20 years ago and are now fully back in operation. Again, this shows the power of all these small-scale techniques applied widely over a landscape. You know, the alternate means of getting water to Indians is the idea or the concept of mega dams and of interlinking river project. If the interlinking river project were to happen, it would be the largest engineering feat on the face of the planet. the ecological and human toll of such major moving rivers, nobody could really know what the unintended consequences of that and the fight for trying to even implement something like that. Removing, displacing whole entire communities is really questionable. Efforts like what was happening in Rajasthan don't have all of those costs accompanying them. And the third element was fire. And so this was interesting. This took me all over. I was down here in Tamil Nadu and up in Maharashtra. But everywhere I was traveling for this book, I would see the evidence of the fact that 160 million households in India are still dependent on this wood. Women with huge loads on top of their head, kids scrambling up trees, cutting the last remaining branches. This was a house in Bihar that was just covered with dung patties that were drying. And the health impacts of this are just staggering. I mean, when I wrote this book, the Global Burden of Disease study had determined that 4 million people a year are dying from the smoke from these fires. So that's like 4 million. How do you wrap your head around that huge of a number? That's more than malaria and HIV AIDS and tuberculosis combined. So we spend a lot of time thinking about how to solve those health problems, but very little is talked about with just especially women and children bearing the brunt of sitting over these fires day after day. Just literally in the past week or two, that number seems to have gone up to 5.5 million. So I mean, each time they study this, it seems like the impact is even greater than previously believed. On top of the human health impact, there's a huge climate impact. So this is this was taken on my way to Mumbai, but I was spending time in Delhi on this trip. The air quality is, there literally is a black cloud over South Asia. It's estimated that about a fifth of this pollution is actually generated from inside the home from these cook stoves. So this is a tremendous, you can't even say indoor versus outdoor air quality. Now they just call it ambient air quality because it's really so intricately intertwined. You know, even in the cities, about 10% of the problems that we're facing in Delhi and other major cities are coming from these biomass stoves being used on a daily basis. So again, this book, I was trying to find hopeful stories and hopeful answers. This one was a little more complicated. When I was working in my 20s with a nonprofit organization in rural Oregon, part of the work we did was actually building and developing fuel-efficient wood cook stoves. So this right here is an EnviroFit stove. This is a spin-off of some of the designs that we came up with there in Oregon. And the idea is that you're building a highly efficient wood cook stove. It's well insulated. Smoke is actually just incomplete combustion. So if you can make that fire burn really hot, it'll burn really clean. And then you get a fire that looks gorgeous like this, where it's all fire and no smoke. The tricky thing was that when I went out to really look for these stoves in action, they were not really being used on a widespread basis. This is an example from Maharashtra here. These stoves, the improved stove is the one in the corner that's not being used. And all the ingredients were good for this project. Cummins, it was part of a CSR program, so the women got the stoves for free. A really great NGO that was working in the area that was well regarded helped distribute the stoves, and it was a fairly well-designed, low-cost stove. It had like nice fire bricks that were surrounded by something that a potter could do locally. It had an air intake hole to help it get that combustion complete. And yet the women were just not using them. And it was a whole host of reasons. That air intake hole, that was where the scorpions and snakes were gonna live. So the first thing they did was plug that up. So then it's not burning as cleanly. And it didn't get it quite hot enough. So the roti didn't cook the way that they liked it to. So then they fired up the chula. Or they did like it, but then the wires fell apart once it got burnt out, and they just called the local potter to fix it, and then they're back to a chula instead of an improved stove. So a lot of these cultural reasons seem to really come into play, and I think that's a huge important thing when we're thinking about development, that technology is providing a lot of amazing answers in many respects, but then there's this huge cultural component that needs to be contended with. Because the stoves do often work really great in the labs. How do you translate that to having them work great. They only work great if they're actually being used. And I found like a hint of answer actually here in Elathigiri in Tamil Nadu, where it's a little bit more developed than some of the kitchens that I was seeing in Maharashtra. And what you see is a slightly messy kitchen like this, where this woman actually on a daily basis was using 4 different stoves. You know, she'd use the kerosene and LPG as long as the subsidies lasted. And she had an Envirofit, one of those improved cook stoves that she'd bought through a self-help group that she was part of, you know, voluntarily with her own money. And then outside, downstairs, she had a 3-stone fire that she used to heat up bath water with the coconut fronds that fell off the tree next door. And this is the stove designers call this stove stacking. And it's actually something all of us probably in this room do on a daily basis, right? We probably have a geyser to heat our water, maybe an LPG stove, maybe a rice cooker. So we have all these different methods. And this is actually like a really positive step in terms of development. It's just like slowly get people off biomass. At the same time, there were certain researchers who've been working on these stoves for 40 years, and they just said, why are we even bothered trying to get these improved cook stoves to women? We wouldn't use them. Why are we asking poor women to use them? Like, if we improve our vehicle fleet emissions by 1%, we can offset all of the fossil fuel, I mean, all of the carbon impact of switching poor women to like clean, dependable fuels, even if they're fossil fuels. Or take it one step further and think about that 25% of the population that doesn't have electricity. Maybe getting really focusing development efforts on renewable microgrids or something to get that power to people that offers all these different benefits, and then you can start thinking about dependable electrical induction stoves or something in that direction. So this basically raised the idea, I mean, I know it sounds like a lot of the students work with NGOs. I love NGOs. I have a deep passion for the work of NGOs and have done that for half of my adult life. And so I believe in that work tremendously, but then there's also the need to recognize when there are limitations to the work that's being done within that realm. There is, I realized as I reported on this, that if you're working for an NGO, you have to say that what you're doing is successful. Like, that's how the funding stays happening, right? So that is a really challenging thing because it is not conducive to just being really honest about the things that are lacking about the programs that NGOs are undertaking. I was really impressed with the work of JPAL, is the Jamil Poverty Action Lab. I don't know if anybody knows that, based out of MIT. Very active in South Asia. They're using randomized controlled trials to try to test some of these theories, you know, like what are NGOs and governments doing? You know, is it better to just give away the bed nets to fight malaria? Is it better to give a deworming pill to kids to keep them in school? Like, what are all these social programs that are in effect? What's working? What's not? What gives you the biggest bang for the buck? So Jay Powell was looking at some of these things like cook stoves as well as many of these other issues. And that approach seemed to me to make a lot of sense in terms of really trying to have NGOs maybe just detach a teeny bit from their work to really try to assess what's being effective and what's not to move forward. So vultures is where the whole book began. I actually started working on the vulture decline here in South Asia like 10 years ago, before I ever remotely thought about writing a book. And so the vultures are in absolute dire crisis. About in the mid-90s, they literally started falling dead from trees. Nobody knew why. Very few people were even paying attention to the fact that they were falling dead from trees. And it took this whole kind of amazing conservation sleuthing effort from scientists all over the world to figure out even what was going on. And they finally isolated it, and it was just this very innocuous painkiller, an NSAID called diclofenac. Humans have taken it for decades, and then in the 90s, farmers started giving it to their cow. So if you have a cow that's kind of limping its way and you want to get it through harvest and you give it a shot of diclofenac, it's a very happy cow, it forgets its foot hurts and gets through harvest, but maybe it's really sick and then it dies. And if that animal has diclofenac in its body, the vultures would come and feed on it and they just have zero tolerance for it. They have renal failure and they die. So you caught this, that kind of scenario caused a 97 to 99% collapse in one decade. It was the fastest avian decline in the history of humankind. So what does that mean? What happens when you once had so many vultures that you didn't even know how to count them? You know, but nobody even paid any attention to them. And then they were just gone. And they had served forever as the garbage collectors of South Asia, literally going out, cleaning up the dead in the place where they had died, so farmers wouldn't even have to deal with it. The vultures would just go and clean it up. So I went trying to figure out what are the ramifications of this. I traveled all over North India. This was, you know, because I'd worked on the story for so long, I went back to places repeatedly. I spent time in the field with conservation biologists who were studying the last remaining nests. So we would be up the Chambal River, you know, looking at nest sites where there used to be 100 and there would be 4 birds. So they were documenting the decline to just try to gather whatever information they could. And I asked, this is Munir, I asked him what happens when you have this ecological niche that's just vacated? And I warn you, there's a couple slightly graphic images coming up, but what happens is that niche, by all appearances, there's no way to absolutely prove this, but as the vultures population crashed, feral dog populations have gone up. And you've got now dogs, I mean, I'm reading this morning's paper was talking about the impact of leopard populations following, the dogs are a food source for the leopards, and leopards, vultures don't like people. They just don't like us. You know, they want nothing to do. The biggest defense mechanism is they vomit and they fly away, which is great. We don't want to go near them, right? But they don't want to go near us either. And they only are scavenging. They're only eating dead stuff. Dogs, totally different. Dogs are predatory. They do kill. They attack children. I wrote about a girl who had been a young, I forget, boy or girl that had been killed here in Bengaluru. But they are a huge problem. You also have to deal with all that dead stuff that the vultures used to go and consume. So I went to, in western Rajasthan, to Bikaner, a carcass dump, where now they collect the dead from this whole region. And it's basically like a feeding ground for feral dogs. I also went up to Haryana, where they've captured the last remaining birds that they could get their hands on. And they're actually doing captive breeding of vultures, which is something that had never been done before. They're using a combination of natural breeding techniques. They're using incubators. Here she's showing me the size of a little vulture chick when it comes hatched. And then they've got vultures in aviaries, and they're basically just waiting very patiently until they can be absolutely sure that diclofenac is removed from the environment. And it's getting closer and closer. India was very proactive about banning the veterinary use of diclofenac back in 2006, but the black market has been just too easy to get the human formulation and still give it to livestock. There have been some indications in the past year that they're like reducing the vial size, and maybe that'll make it harder for vets to want to use this drug on their cattle anymore, but right now they have not been able to release the birds. So their birds are patiently waiting, and the biologists are working very hard with very thankless work to try to continue to raise money to feed vultures. It's not the same as tigers. And then, this is just so fascinating, it had this whole religious implication. The Parsis, mostly based up in Mumbai, for thousands of years have laid out their dead on top of towers of silence for the vultures to eat. They've done this since the times of Herodotus, who documented it, and they just don't believe in cremation, they don't believe in burial. Those elements are sacred and you can't pollute it with a dead body. So the sky burial was a perfect way of disposing of their dead until the vultures didn't come anymore, and then the whole system just came to a grinding halt. What they're trying to do now is they have solar collectors aimed at the towers in hopes of sort of desiccating the bodies. Mixed results on whether this is working or not. I imagine that it's really not working very well during monsoon season. And then it's caused a schism within the Parsi community, because some Parsis, like this woman Dunbaria, are just saying, we need to adapt. The vultures are gone. We need to allow burial. We need to allow cremation into our rituals and allow the prayers to take place as they should in the fire temples. We can't ban this anymore. Like, we have to adapt. So all these questions of adaptation, both for the vultures as a species and for human communities, to this changing world. And the vulture story was also a story just about unintended consequences, how much we need to recognize that that is such a part of these ecological problems. There's no way that anybody could have predicted that the vultures would decline because of this drug being given to goats and cattle. There's no way. So just a dose of humility, perhaps, in terms of thinking about the effects that our actions take on our surroundings, and then how that those changes come back to us. And then the last section was ether. So this is Akasha. This is the space between spaces. And I wanted to, I originally went into this planning on talking about population specifically. I decided to go to Bihar, which is one of the places with some of the youngest brides and some of the highest birth rates, to see what efforts were being taken to try to change that. And I met, you know, the girl in red is 14, 15 years old when I met her. She was already married for a year. There were other girls who were really seeking some way to maybe change the paths of their lives. And then I ended up focusing in on the work of Pathfinder International, which is an NGO, and specifically the teacher trainer, Pinky Kumari, who was 30 years old when I met her and basically had this amazing story of her own kind of fight with her parents to let her stay in school and delay her marriage and not get married off at 16. She was amazingly successful, went on to get a master's at Leeds, and continues to work in reproductive and sexual health training. As I was working on that part of the story, was right around the same time of the gang rape in Delhi. There was a lot of just talking about women's autonomy and girls' autonomy, just to not only have their lives, let them be able to stay in school and be educated, but also to just be safe, both in their homes and on the streets. So Pathfinder was doing really basic, simple things. They were training teenagers with a 3-day reproductive and sexual health training. Super basic stuff. What is menstruation? Why you should stay in school until the legal age of 18 to get married? What happens, what physiologically happens in the body in terms of developing in those few years? How to talk about birth control with their partners, how to decide how many children to have, how to space out those children. And, you know, I went to Bihar thinking this was going to be a really, really tough story to report, but I ended up being really encouraged by the girls that I met there. They were just, seemed like this small bit of knowledge for them, gave them an autonomy and a voice that they didn't have in other respects. It was almost as though by teaching them about their own bodies, they were learning how to speak up in other realms of their life as well. Some of the girls that I met had just gone on to teach, you know, took what they learned and went to their villagers and were teaching other kids as well. So it ended up being a really pretty hopeful story. So to wrap it up, I mean, I'm not a policymaker. I'm not an eco-entrepreneur. I'm not a scientist. I don't work in development. But so many of the people that I met didn't either. They were just doing things in their own lives that were transforming both their own trajectory as well as the state of their own landscape. And I just wonder what would happen if there was support for a lot of these grassroots efforts coming from the top down as well. Because right now that seems like that's what's missing, is that there's like all these isolated little efforts happening and people feel like they're pushing stones uphill. And so maybe I'll just read a little bit from the conclusion and then we can open it up to questions. As I traveled across the subcontinent, I asked nearly everyone I met, "Do you have hope?" I asked the biologists Munir and Patrick as we sipped tea along the shores of a lake in Rajasthan. I asked activists I met in Bengaluru and epidemiologists from Chennai. I asked Pinky and Binod in the car heading back to Patna, and farmers as we sat in fields in Punjab. A few offered an unequivocal yes, others a resounding no. But most often I received halting replies as people desperately tried to fashion optimistic but not always convincing answers. In Rajasthan, something changed. Kanhi and I were standing at the top of the hill behind his house, overlooking the Baunta Valley, verdant and invigorated by small-scale waterworks. There, under a cerulean sky, I realized I'd been asking the wrong question all along. I was using hope as a noun when I should have been using it as a verb, as something active and ongoing. I was using hope as a thing to be possessed, something you either had or lacked. Instead of asking, do you have hope, I should have been asking, do you hope? We hope for a bountiful harvest from a Punjabi field that leaves the soil and water intact. He hopes for a vulture's survival as he lets it loose from his hands into the wild. She hopes for a future she begins to imagine on a cloudy afternoon in a one-room schoolhouse in Bihar. To hope is also to act, and now is India's time for action. Now is the moment to build a new economy that cultivates the country's people and also safeguards its irreplaceable natural resources. At this moment, India must decide what her future will be. Two paths present themselves as her development efforts advance. Macro is the way of the past and of the West. In the 20th century Europe and North America, to develop was to go big. Rapid advancements in technology enabled humans to build ever more complicated systems to create energy, siphon water, and grow food. Mega dams grew to such epic proportions that they drew tourists. Big concrete, big steel. We split atoms to release previously unimaginable amounts of energy. Industrialization, not limited to manufacturing, became the model by which to raise meat and grow crops. These efforts were incredibly productive. They also came at untold collateral cost to the environment and human communities, and they have proven unsustainable over the long term. India could follow the West down this well-worn path of the big, wrenching every last resource from the ecosystems of South Asia and giving back nothing. It takes little imagination to envision such a future. Overhead will be the blackened skies of England in the mid-19th century, or America soon after, or Beijing yesterday, or New Delhi today. This addiction to the big will result in more dead zones where the rivers meet the seas, like the ones in the Gulf of Mexico and the Baltic Sea, caused from the agricultural runoff and pollution. Indian rivers will run so thick with effluent that they burst into flames, as Ohio's Cuyahoga River repeatedly did. Or India could choose the other path, just as she created her own form of democracy, intrinsically Indian and not just a replica of the Western model. She could create her own way to develop her people and resources. Growth could be guided by environmental self-rule. Call it eco-swaraj, something only a few developed countries have tried on a large scale, and that is nearly non-existent in the developing world. Imagine an India in which innovation comes from the micro, where communities of the grassroots decide what they need and how to get it. A bottom-up approach to India's environmental crises can feed people without depleting the soil, draw water from wells without diminishing aquifers or displacing communities, fuel India's growing energy needs without wrecking the environment. The technology exists and is continually improving, and coupled with the traditional knowledge that remains, could be transformative. I think this is what India is just poised to be, the place that creates a whole new model of development for the 21st century that's based on techniques that are more sustainable than those of the past. It's not a, I believe that it's not a mutually exclusive method that you can develop, you know, because we want to bring those development lags, we want to fill them, right? So there's a way to do that, but it doesn't need to involve how it's been done in the past. India is a perfect place for this model to emerge. It's a place of small farmers, of small shopkeepers. You haven't already, because of those development lags, there's an element of a blank slate there in terms of deciding how you want to set it up for the future. You're not already locked into absolutely needing a car to get everywhere. In the US, you can't exist in most parts of the country without having a vehicle, private vehicle, and all of the traffic that involves. India is heading in that direction, but you are not locked into it yet. There's still time to change that trajectory. This quote, India must view the era of the green economy not as a threat to its development plans. Instead, it must be viewed as an opportunity to build and demonstrate technological capability to the world. I think it's easy to forget that India created a whole new model for revolution here. India did this not that long ago. The world had never seen a non-violent revolution that had gotten colonial powers out of their backyard. And it happened here in India, and it became a model for the US for the civil rights movement 20 years later. So the idea that right now India is poised to do this and could become the model, not only for how India develops, but how China continues to develop, how Africa develops, how US decides to do infrastructure 2.0 now that our infrastructure that we put in 80 years ago is slowly crumbling. So I think that there's a lot of hope for what could happen here in India, and that there's a lot that the rest of the world could learn and that India could benefit from heading in that direction. Whether it happens remains to be seen. So thank you, and I welcome your questions. Huh. Oh, here, we have a microphone here.
Hello.
Hi, perfect.
Meera, how did you plan your itinerary, and how do you decide what is elementary in a traditional way, and how do you see the complexities? Like, you have taken the example of Parsis and the Tower of Silence, you know. They have decided to do away with the Tower of Silence.
They still have the Towers of Silence. They're still there in Mumbai. They're still operating every day. So the towers are there. They're using solar collectors as an attempt to desiccate them. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Basically. So did you see the transition? Were they going in for incineration and all that?
Many Parsis are going towards cremation and burial. The big sticking point is that those who choose to do that are not allowed to have the prayers and the final rituals happen at the fire temples there at the Dungarwadi at Malabar Hill, which is the main area where the towers are. So it's an entire system. If you are a Parsi and someone in your family dies, you call Malabar Hill and the whole system is there in place. If you want to choose to cremate or bury your family member, then you have to do everything yourself. You're sort of locked out of the main Parsi system. So that's where, and that's just coming from the Parsi Panchayat, who wants to, you know, there's orthodox beliefs within that system that they just do not want to allow it. So there's some renegade priests that are willing to do these, but they're not allowed to do them in the temples there at Malabar Hill. So it's causing a schism within the community because some people feel like they have to adapt and other ones are trying to figure out if there's some other way. There have been talks of building an aviary with the Tower of Silence in the middle and the vultures would be inside, but from all the scientists and biologists I talked to, it would be dooming those vultures to death because diclofenac is in hundreds of formulations that humans take, and it's very likely that a human body would also have those chemicals in it that would kill the vultures. I want some good student questions. Is this going to be easy? Can we do this? It's not going to be easy, even if we can.
I know this wasn't strictly your focus, so putting you a little bit outside maybe of... I'm trying to think... of the usual question of scale and how one takes so many examples, of which there are many, and you've seen yourself and there are many others, and how one really builds a politics, for lack of a better word, of this kind of a thing. So Eco Swaraj is basically a political idea. It's not a technical idea.
Right.
So it's not about knowing how to do things, which we do know, but about changing something else, somewhere else, whether it's Delhi or Bangalore, in terms of the political thinking. So did you ever talk to people about this or?
Yeah, I mean, that is the biggest conundrum of the whole thing because the efforts are there. And I think it's good to remember that Margaret Mead quote about it doesn't take, 75% of the population rushing out to the streets. It takes a small portion of engaged people who are basically expressing the sentiments of all those other people who just don't have time to make it to the rally, right? So getting those people out, it tips the needle, and we've seen this time and time again everywhere. And so that is what gives me hope. I get especially as I've been talking about this book in India for over a month now, and I think this is my fourth city, and the recurring topic of corruption, of having good laws on paper that are not implemented or enforced is a recurring theme. And that is, India has a huge, huge battle around that. But then the follow-up that always comes up in that conversation is that everybody's part of it. I mean, this is a democracy, right? So whoever's up there has been voted in, even if we don't like our choices. Lord knows we're looking at Trump in the US, so I'm speaking, we're all in this together. And so the corruption part, you know, people say, well, I paid the cops off too so that I didn't have to be bothered to go pick up my license the next day. So recognizing the participation, and I think that is something that that is the place where there's the most room for change to happen. The fact that there's been a huge, huge growth in the middle class in India over the past generation, that has been the part that has benefited from a lot of these economic reforms. Figure out what's gonna happen with that freedom that has been bought of not having to worry about daily needs anymore. Is it gonna go towards the cool latest gadget or game, or is it gonna go towards becoming a more engaged citizen within your town and country? Because it doesn't take much. We have seen evidence that, you know, people just pushing for, when I was doing that organic farming in my 20s, my parents thought I was crazy. Everybody thought I was crazy, living on this farm, organic, whatever. Nobody had even heard of it. It was like this hippie thing left over from the 70s. And by the time I go to New York City in 2003 for grad school, every little corner store has organic milk. And people are talking about where their food comes from. And they're talking about how far it's traveled before it's gotten to their plate. And they want to know the name of their chicken before they eat it, right? So this change can happen in a very short order, like when you least expect it. And that's, as much as the stories of corruption and political lags and just feeling like you're going one step up and two steps back or five steps back, there are all these moments that we can think of that show that we are moving in towards more of these efforts and more connection. It's just a matter of whether we can turn it into something that's more than just this small scale effort. Oh, come on, one student. Good.
Yeah, hi, Meera. My question is, when maximum percentage of you, the Indian population is below poverty line, and many of us are hand to mouth, how do you see this concept of organic farming coming in? Because it seems as an elitist concept to Indians. So how do you see it happening in the near future?
I mean, that's where I got encouragement from the farmers that I was meeting. I mean, I think a big tricky thing with organic is it costs more to buy. Right now, I don't fully understand why it costs more. There is more human labor involved in creating it, but you also are not spending money on all those the proprietary seeds and all the inputs. So somehow the economics of that should work out. But even if the middle class are the only ones who can afford to buy organic, it's still supporting that entire economy of the farmers who are working the land. So that's got huge health impacts for the laborers, for the farmers. You know, there was one study that said organic food, you know, an organic carrot has no more vitamins than a non-organic carrot. And I feel like that is not really part of the equation. I'm thinking about the poor laborer who's spending all day growing that carrot, and the chemicals that they're exposed to, and the water that they have, you know, their daily lives. So there's this whole, again, thinking about it in an ecosystem approach. You know, it's like your carrot isn't just the carrot that you're putting in your body and it's just you and the carrot. No, you have this entire ecosystem around growing that one bit of food. And so I think for some of the farmers that I met, they were doing it because they wanted to get out from this cycle of debt, of constantly being told that the next product that they would buy from a corporation. The tricky thing, and I can go more into the science if you want, but a lot of these methods of the Green Revolution work to a point and then they stop working. And then you need to do the next thing to combat that problem that stemmed from the first. So you've got this endless cycle of trying to like solve the next problem, usually with something that you need to buy from the company that gave you the problem in the first place. So that was a real impetus for a lot of the farmers that I met, of just like, I don't want to be in this anymore. I want to like create soil and an ecosystem here on my farm that works for the long term without constantly doing the inputs. I mean, I don't dive into the whole genetically modified issue, but genetically modified cotton deals with boll weevil. That's one pest, one major, major pest, granted, but it's one pest. So when you get rid of that, again, the whole nature abhors a vacuum, like the vultures, you know, something else comes in, and it comes in very short order. I mean, there was one study that came out of Cornell looking at BT cotton in China, and they found, you know, like 3 years into growing this cotton, that the farmers were making like way more money, and they were spraying chemicals way less because the GM dealt with the pests. But 7 years into it, which is like a little blink of an eye in terms of agriculture sustainability forever and ever for generations, 7 years into using this new seed, the farmers were spraying the same amount as with the non-genetically modified seeds, because again, the pests had just adapted very quickly. You know, the strongest ones survived and they go on to make more. And the farmers were losing money because they were paying for these seeds that cost three times as much as the non-genetically modified seeds. So it's just this endless, endless race. And I mean, the corporate influence is a big part of it. It's like eight companies control two-thirds of the proprietary seed market. They control two-thirds of the fertilizers and pesticides. It's a huge, huge amount of money. When farmers decide not to buy into that system, they are losing out on that money. They're losing market share. An encouraging thing is I was in Oklahoma back in September, which is kind of our Punjab, like our heartland of America. This is not a radical, progressive, hippie place at all. And yet they were incorporating some of these techniques that I saw farmers in Punjab using, like no-till farming and really looking at water conservation. And they were doing it because they saw that they were about to enter another dust bowl. Like the environmental situation was so dire. The soil was dead. Literally, when soil dies, it can't, there's nothing active alive keeping it whole. So they'd get pouring rains. Remember that flooding drought cycle? That was what was happening in Oklahoma. Pouring rains, and it would be like it was hitting concrete. It would never permeate the soil because the soil was just like nothing left but clay, dust bowl. Like before it blows away, it's just like rock. And so they were incorporating like a very large percentage of the farmers across the state were starting to incorporate some of these methods because it was in their interest. And then the corporate entities in that area were like, oh, we're coming up with this new hocus pocus stuff. It's microorganisms you can add to the soil. So they were like heading towards the organic natural, trying to figure out how they can get into that market. Bless them. I think that's great. If they are heading into that and it makes more sustainable soil, then that might be a good way to go. But so I feel like there's evidence that even those hand-to-mouth farmers would really benefit from this, not only on the personal health level, but even on the economic level. There's no way to absolutely say that the farmer suicides are just like directly linked to the economic, you know, the expenditures that they have to make, but it's part of the equation, definitely. I think that's obvious. Thanks. Good question. Over here.
Hi.
Hi.
So I just wanted to ask you, how difficult was it to see the transition from chemical farming to organic farming? I don't think so. It's very, I think most of the farmers are adapted to chemical farming, and then is it a community level decision which they take to switch over to organic farming? I mean, it's really difficult for one farmer to switch over to organic farming. I mean, how did that transition take place?
Yeah, because India is a land of mostly small farmers, most people were doing it on an individual level. In places like Kepti Barasat Mission is based in Jaitu in Punjab, and that area, because of that NGO training, so many people there had a much higher concentration of farmers who were doing it. But it still was farm by farm people deciding. So I was sitting there, you know, talking to one farmer, and that picture of the guy who was spraying chemicals, as I'm interviewing the organic farmer, you know, 50 feet away on the next farm, but it's right there, they're spraying chemicals. So there's that part of the equation, but the it was definitely seemed to be radiating out as farmers tried it. Then other farmers could just be like, well, I'm not ready to take that gamble, but I'm willing to watch him and see how he does. And I definitely met farmers who were doing that. And then also what Gwara Singh was doing was very common. Don't do all of the lands at once. Transition slowly so that it's not, because there is, it takes time for the soil to build back up and to get it back to a place that is gonna be getting you the yields that are gonna approximate those that you were getting with the inputs. So doing that slowly is also another excellent way for that to happen. Very interestingly, he was totally keeping the organic produce for his own family. All the rest was going to market. Like, so where the farmers are choosing, like what they're choosing to eat and feed their families, shows, I think, reveals a lot about how they feel about these systems. And then, was there anything else you asked? I think that was it, yeah. Those are, India is mostly small farmers. One farmer I read about who had 130 acres, seventh generation Punjabi farmer, pretty well off. He went to one of these Kativaraset missions and just to oblige a friend. And it was like a religious conversion for him. He's just like, oh my God, why am I using all these things? And he stopped overnight. But he had the economic resources to ride him through that. Cause it took him, I was like, oh, how did that go? And he's like, oh, it was terrible. But he was able to ride that economically because he had the savings to do that and the power to do that. Most small farmers can't afford to make that kind of like blunt transition in that respect. So it's very easy. It's 3:20, should one more or any? Okay, good.
Hi, thanks for this brilliant talk. And we see all these local initiatives being happening from society level, as in mostly people coming up on their own and trying these things. When you see the role of the state in something like Green Revolution, it was immense. But when you talk about these initiatives, you see very little, even the ideology of the Indian state, support these systems. It's very, very weak. And somewhere I feel they don't even feel, because what we saw going out at the global level is America has done it and we'll do it again. We'll show it to them that we can do it.
Right.
So when you see these things floating around, how do you,
That's again where that political thing comes in, because the corporate influence is really huge. I mean, Rachel Carson, when she wrote about Silent Spring, she's like, 99% of the entomologists, this is 1960s US, were studying chemical ways to deal with pests instead of like understanding how pests work and how their ecosystems work and what might naturally work to fight them or to encourage the good pests and not the bad ones. So it's an old story that the energy goes towards these things. I mean, a very good metaphor, I imagine, is like we spend a lot of time and money and resources globally to try to figure out how to cure cancer. There's almost no talk about how to prevent cancer in the first place, right? Nobody wants to go through cancer treatment. How do we prevent this? How do we figure out root causes of some of these problems and try to address those? But there's not much money to be made in that. I'm not an anti-capitalist per se, but it's just frustrating because there's just so much influence that comes from those economic systems. And government entities benefit from that. So how that again takes civilian engagement in saying we don't want to head in that direction, we want to head in this direction. We want to vote for you if you head in this direction. We supporting those endeavors, either as a consumer or as a voter, to make those efforts bear fruit, because there's a lot of opposition coming from really powerful forces that are, in this case, often outside of India. I mean, I was really struck by as I was reporting on this, I totally understood and it made sense that India wanted to become food independent. Like, India was so dependent on these shiploads of food coming in. When it became its own nation. That totally made sense, but then as I reported on this, I'm like, has India just traded that its dependency on these boatloads of grain for boatloads of technology, of seeds, of all the inputs? Like, most of that stuff is coming from Western companies. It's not coming indigenously. It's not money that's staying in the country, even in the country, let alone in a region. It's, so have you just traded one dependence for another one? I think that's part of the equation too.
Did you happen to talk to any of the elected local representatives, and what was their stand on these issues?
some of them. I mean, there was definitely, I mean, even Vinogiani, the farmer who had 130 acres, he was involved with politics and everything like that. So there were some people that were already bridging that divide, but for the most part, I mean, at one point I talked to Navdanya up in Uttarakhand, and the fellow there said, you know, when I asked him about the government, because I was hearing at that point, this is happy news that Sikkim has gone totally organic. That was like in the works when I was working on this book, and it just happened, you know, whatever, since I landed in India 3 weeks ago. Amazing, by the way, like that's not even being discussed in the US, you know, of like an entirely organic state. It's not Punjab, it's not the breadbasket, but still it's really encouraging. But I was asking him at Navdanya about these efforts. I'm like, what's going on? I'm hearing, you know, entire states are talking about going organic, but then I hear they're gonna bring the green revolution to Bihar. Like, what's going on here? And he's like, yeah, the government wants to be in two boats at the same time. And that is what I seem to sense the most from the research and the interviews that I was doing, is that there is, and Prime Minister Modi definitely seems to be doing that across the board. Energy, for example, building coal-fired power plants at the same time as promoting renewables, like, maybe that needs to happen in terms of this like all energy sources thing, but also if you redirected all of that energy towards renewables and really tried to do what like Germany did or is doing, something altogether new could happen.
Thank you for the talk. Can you briefly reflect on how you found your cases, how you chose the cases you chose? And also, were there any moments of, you know, bafflement and opacity, and I don't quite understand this, in terms of what you were trying to grasp by way of an instructive or the constructive in, engagement?
Great. In terms of finding the stories, I mean, the vultures was already had been there, and then the framework, the idea of using the Panchamahabhuta as like a framework for it came pretty early on in the process, so that helped me like zoom in. I'm like, okay, what water stories are happening? And I was looking for, I was trying to find hopeful, positive stories. I mean, I could have written an entire book about mega dams and farmer suicides, and wouldn't that have been fun to report and read? No. So I was trying to find something like, we're deluged with the bad news every day in our newspaper. That's what the newspaper is going to give you. So I was trying to seek out the stories that were maybe offered a hint of some sort of other alternative. So that was part of the guidance. And then geographically, I was trying to get a good representation of the country. I didn't want to just all be in one area. I ended up focusing on Punjab and Rajasthan in that area a little bit more, it seemed like. But I tried to just because the country is so diverse, I wanted to try to get representation in that respect. So that Google map that I showed you in the beginning, if I showed you the one that was the research one that had like every possible story, it's just plastered. And then it was a question of sometimes just access. Some stories seemed really great, but it seemed like the contacts were not there, or it was just gonna be too difficult to report on some level. And even many places that I went and reported on, again, just didn't make it into the book because I was trying to not write an encyclopedia of every farmer that I met. I mean, I interviewed hundreds of people for this book, and it's really just a couple dozen that actually make it in. So I would just try to find the stories that seemed to, you know, one farmer who represented what I met five farmers who were telling me, but this one story, he had the most compelling stories about why he was doing what he was doing, and so that would be the one that would make the cut. I actually handed in a manuscript that was like way too long. Wonderful editors helped me condense it into something more readable. Did you ask a second question too? What was it? Was I baffled? Constantly baffled. I mean, I went from NGO work, like the reason why I shifted to journalism was because I was doing more and more writing for the NGOs, and I realized that, you know, you have an NGO, you have a mission statement, and you need to stick to that mission statement. It's kind of like going back to the funding question where as I was doing that work, I realized like all of these stories are way more complicated that I'm allowed to talk about them. And that was really my personal driving reason for going into journalism and yet still covering the exact same types of topics I've been doing since I was 19. And the cook stove is a perfect example where it's like, I loved those cook stoves. I built them, I cooked with them. They're totally cool, but the reality of what that's like, especially if that is your every single meal stove, becomes something totally different. So lots of times I was baffled as I was doing the stories, like I just found unexpected things, which is what I love about the work of a journalist, is that you just have to be open to that, and that's part of the story, is that the answers are never, none of these, you know, in some ways I'm pushing something in the conclusion, but I know it's not as easy as just digging a couple dams and switching to organic on a little farm. Like, these are huge, huge complicated issues. There's no easy answer for any of them. But I think more than anything, I think I'm advocating for just a slight shift in perspective about what direction we could go and what direction, how that might be able to move in one direction versus another.
Thank you, Meera. Please join me in thanking Meera for a lovely talk.
Thank you. And there's books outside, and I'm here. I have some time before I have to race off, so if anybody else has any questions, feel free to come up.